On this episode of Between Two Beers, we talk to Kris Bright. Brighty has had one of the most colourful and interesting careers of any footballer in New Zealand. He played professionally for 13 clubs in 11 countries over 12 years, but he hates being called a journeyman. In this episode, we find out why, along with details of the time he thought he was going to die after training, breaking his leg 3 days before he was meant to sign a 3-year deal with a Champions League club, why he's never drunk alcohol, and many of the hardest times from 12 years on the road. Brighty is currently one of New Zealand's top young coaches and currently holds 4 coaching roles: Central United, Auckland City Youth, Diocesan First 11, and Head of Football at Auckland Grammar. This was an incredibly insightful and wide-ranging 2-hour chat, and I really enjoyed how open Brighty was about all the good times and the bad. Hope you enjoy. Kris Bright, welcome to Between Two Beers.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
Good. Kris has come straight from Central training. They just started their pre-season campaign, so very lucky to have him in studio. He's made the time, 8:30, he's come straight from training. Looking great, Kris, looking in good nick. Shay, why don't we get started? How do you know Kris Bright?
I think it was in the year 2000 when I was playing for Claudelands Rovers, and Kris Bright is looking vaguely into the distance here, but I believe he was playing for North Shore United Reserves.
Wow.
With a very, very young team. Alan Hill. No, it wasn't Alan Hill.
No, it wasn't.
Next to Devonport on the side of the road there.
Devonport Domain?
Yep. So we played you. I can't remember the result.
I tell you what, I think I missed a penalty that day.
You did miss a penalty that day.
Tony Jasper does not shut up about this penalty miss. It was the thing, the only one I've ever missed in my career.
You're welcome.
And Tony Jasper does. I can't believe you remember that.
Hey, and that's what I do, is I bring this detail to the podcast. And then international teams, and then most recently in his capacity at Central United with some of the national team stuff I've been doing with the under-23s late last year. So, yeah, that's kind of how I know Brighty. What about you, Steve?
I don't know Brighty that well. We're similar ages. What are you?
Are we?
I'm 34.
Okay, 33.
Yeah. So I'd say.
Okay, well, that's fair.
Should we say similar?
That's pretty similar. Pretty
close, I'm not going to lie.
You can't go
similar,
much closer without being the same. We don't know each other that well, surprisingly, because we've sort of hung out in similar circles. Perhaps the fact that he's played for about a million clubs overseas during the majority of his career meant our paths didn't quite cross. But I've definitely known of him. I've sort of kept track of how you've been progressing in the game. And I think every time you'd come back to New Zealand, I'd see you from time to time, wherever you'd pop up. Looking forward to in the last 24 hours when we've been going through the Kris Bright research, it's been quite staggering, really, the amount of content to talk about.
Yeah.
I think Brighty has the honour of being the Kiwi who's played for the most clubs, 13,
wow.
I think I've got.
Pro clubs.
And in the most countries, which is 11, I believe. So just to give a bit of perspective on exactly what we're dealing with here, For someone who doesn't know Kris Bright, I'm going to run through the clubs and countries because there are some weird and wacky names in here. This is to give a bit of a glimpse into the sort of career he's had. Okay. Waitakere City, Canterbury United, New Zealand Knights, Fortuna Sittard in Holland. I'm going to murder some of these, by the way. Mm-hmm. Kristiansund, Norway. Panathinaikos, Greece. Shrewsbury Town, Budapest, Honved in Hungary. Balzan Youths,
and where,
Malta.
Sorry, where was that?
I'm just going to work through them. Brian FK in Norway. FC Haka, Finland. Yeah. IFK Mariehamn, Finland. Lincoln City, Bharat, India. Bidvest
Bidvest-Wits, South Africa, Linfield in Ireland, and finally Auckland City. So, I mean...
You got about 90% of that right, actually.
It's a real...
Pronunciation or accuracy?
I don't know, mate. You're reading it, so I'm not sure myself, to be honest.
It's a real mouthful. It's an incredible career, and I'm looking forward to getting stuck because I know you've got so many good stories from all these places. So we are going to jump around quite a lot. But, Shay, where are we going to start?
Well, maybe before we get into... that let me take you can I take you both back
go on
actually to Gower Park, Hamilton, 2017, Melville United first team training. Kris Bright turns up. First question, how did that happen?
Well we'll back the truck up about a week.
Okay,
we'll back the truck up about a week. So I came back to New Zealand, no one knew. No, I didn't even tell my parents. I turned up. I kept a very, very low profile. Drove to the mighty town of Pirongia.
Beautiful
place. Not a lot happens there. Where my wife's family is from. So whenever we used to come back, we'd always used to pop down there, which was always fun. But I popped in there and we set up camp there, and obviously I told my parents. But then I had the football bug still, so I needed to train. I was in talks with Auckland City, and that looked like it was going to happen, so I thought, well, I better get training. So what did I do? Google, Te Awamutu Football Club.
Good.
No word of a lie. No word of a lie. Found the number of the coach, called them up and said, hey, my name's Kris. I've just come to the area. This would have been, so it was in the winter, so probably about July-ish.
Yeah.
I said, look, can I come down and train? Oh, well, you know, we're quite full. Good. I'm like, look, like, you know, I played a little bit in New Zealand back in the day. Like, I just want to keep fit. Maybe I'll sign for the rest of the season. Who knows? I could just move to Pirongia. Okay, so I go down there. And honestly, great lads. Absolutely fantastic.
You have to say that, though, don't you?
I have to say it because...
Big, we've got a strong Te Awamutu
yeah, just in case
on the cast.
Just in case. So, like, great lads, but I trained with them for a couple of times. Obviously, after the first session, the coach kind of go, look, what's your story? Like, I said, oh, no, I'm just back for a while. I'm going to be moving to Canberra. I made some bullshit story up, to be fair. I felt really bad. I'd go home every night, and my missus' mum was just like, you can't do this. You're taking them. Like, this is a bit unfair. So then I kind of just stopped. I felt really bad. So, Te Awamutu Football Club, I'm incredibly sorry that I didn't really continue to go back. But so I thought, like, I need to up the level slightly. Gave
Huntley a call.
gave Huntley a call in Narrawohia. So what was going on? No, but then I called Sam and he said, yeah, of course, come on down. And then, yeah, that was it. I came to a few sessions. I remember being a five-a-side with Mark Evans and he did not move. I was in a little position. I was furious.
That's where I think you were in that team, Steve?
No. This was before the famous, infamous okay. sort of five or so. This is like in a possession drill or something. Right, Sam, okay. Got off Google. And honestly, I reeked of like a some sort of UEFA coaching book, but it was brilliant.
Bang, bang.
Yeah. And I just remember Mark just not moving. I was like, look, I can't yell at this guy. I don't know who he is. Like, jeez, that was really annoying. But anyway, yeah. Anyway, got to the end part of training. Who was it? Me, you, Jezza.
Oh, that was the highlight of the season for me. I was terrible. I was terrible that year, but that training, I think Jeremy Field was in town.
Yes, yeah.
And
he was.
I think it was a four-a-side comp, and it was me and you and Jeremy Field and Aaron Scott.
Yeah.
And
was
we lit it up.
Or Gavorko in goal?
Oh, might have been big.
I think it was Tony G.
Might have been Tony.
Yeah.
Anyway, unbeatable, unplayable.
Oh, so
it was like rolling back the years, and I realised that maybe four-a-side was my real calling.
It got to the point where we thought, actually, you know, like the old footballer in our mind sort of kicked in, and then we started to try a bit more. Then we got a bit serious. Then in the break, and you know, catching our breath, obviously, trying to talk about tactics and stuff, and yeah, we ran away with it in the end, didn't we? The kids thought we had it. The kids were good, to be fair, but...
I quite enjoyed the fact that you turned up and no one knew who you were. You've had this, you know, you've been a professional footballer for 10 years overseas. And
longer.
And it reminded me, no disrespect, but it reminded me of a story when I was at Melville. So it was the first time that I'd been in Hamilton for years. I'd been in Auckland for about 5 or 6 years playing for Bay Olympic and Glenfield and all that. So I'd sort of fallen out of touch with the Melville youngsters, I guess.
I know where this is going.
And so it's towards the start of the season, and we're doing these games, and Wilkie and Maney are the captains, and they both pick captains. sorry, Wilkie and Mania are the coaches, and they both pick captains to select the teams. So I think there's three captains, and it's sort of, I don't know, 7v7v7. And it starts off, they have a bit of a giggle about the fact that I haven't been picked up very early. And then it sort of turns into, they don't know him at all. They don't know him at all. And then I'm the last pick. So there's about
schoolyard pick.
There's about 21 players there, and I'm the very last pick.
For the second goal.
And they're absolutely pissing themselves at this point, because I thought I still had a little bit in me, and I've been the very last pick. So they thought it was hilarious, but they didn't find it so funny the next session when I was picked last again. I thought maybe I would have offered a little something in that session to
could have been worse. Could have been Cole Tinkler at the Club World Cup, and the assistant coach gets for you. So
yeah.
Every cloud. Mm. Yeah. But what was that like? I mean, you're obviously pretty humble, I guess, to pick up the phone and talk to Te Awamutu Sports and not relay your CV. How is that coming back to New Zealand and kind of not a lot of people knowing your profile and who you are and what you've done?
No, I don't mind. I think it's great. Obviously, I'm not in that sort of that category, that, you know, the top boys, but I'm in that different category of what a lot of people don't actually see or understand when they're playing football. The chances of these boys here in New Zealand now, all these age groups of boys playing in the English Premier League is slim. That's the facts. It's slim. It's possible. Everyone can see. Look, Woodsy's done it. Winston's done it. These boys have all done it. However, it's tough. But you can still be a professional footballer and live your dream without playing in the Premier League. Now, I loved my career. I hated it and I loved it at the same time. But I just went under the radar. I did my thing. And that's what I was just saying to Stephen when I turned up. Like, I stay off social media to a degree. I don't really see what's going on. But unless you search for what I've done, it's, you know, not many people actually know. Geez, looking at the sheet, I don't know myself. I can't remember.
Can't even pronounce these teams' names.
But I don't, like, that's the thing. I just think I just want these boys to realise that, look, I try and help as many people as I can. I remember one kid at Te Awamutu that I was talking to. This sounds ridiculous, but he was kicking the ball like wrong. Like, he was just kicking the ball. It was wrong. Like, he was playing for and so I remember talking to him, trying to help him, and he was really good. And he was and after the second or third session, he actually improved, and I felt good about that. So I'm not sure if it's humble. It's just, just crack on. I just hope that the likes of Winston and Chris, if they do come back and, you know,
they
go to Te Awamutu and help them kick a ball properly.
Right. Well, Brighty, let's get into it. Let's take you right back to the start. We had Cole Tinkler on the pod a couple of weeks ago. Yeah. And he talked about his time at the Knights, and he mentioned your name and you were with him through that journey. Mm-hmm. Did you listen to it, and do his experiences sort of marry up with what you remember?
A little bit, yeah. So it was tough for us because we were so young and we were like, oh my God, this is amazing. So my recollection of the Knights, I thought it was brilliant. The facility, we get to play at North Harbour Stadium, the pitches that we trained on, we played on the one on the front end, the back before it was turf, they were absolutely perfect. We had everything we needed. We did go to the Gold Coast. Yes, Tink said it was a piss up. For some of us, it wasn't, but for most it was to a degree. But I thought it was brilliant. I thought we had good players. We had players like Neil Wemblin. We had players like Darren Bazey. We had Danny Hay. So I really enjoyed it. I just think that they got a few things wrong with the selection in terms of the player personnel. We brought certain players out to New Zealand that were on the down instead of on the up. But like for Tinks and I lived together, we lived with Ben Collett, who had been at Man United his whole life, and that taught us a lot. Ben would get his eggs and only have the egg whites, and he'd be sleeping, he'd go into his room, he'd do all everything so professionally. But in saying that, by the end of the season, he's doing like keg stands and all sorts with, you know, the Aussie boys, and it was an absolute disgrace. Like, we went to Rototo, remember Rototo's?
I remember Rototo's.
Shout out to Rototo's. I don't think that's around anymore. But yeah, he was out there at the end of the season, so they kind of changed him. But I loved it. I got to go to play at Melbourne Victory and Sydney and FC. And I remember Cole playing in that game in Sydney. I was there. I was on the bench. I don't think I played. But played really, really well. And just unfortunately for him, there were just some names ahead of him. He did get a couple of things wrong. I was the apprentice with Jasper and Jeremy Christie, but Brocky and Tinks were both signed. But I think the thing with Tinks and Brocks at the time, because obviously Brocks had a bit of a blip after that, where he went to Sydney, and then after that it was obviously playing nationally. But the money, like I was getting just a little bit of expenses at Waitakere, like basically nothing, and I was second top scorer in the league or something at 17, 18. Then all of a sudden we're getting a big salary. I say a big salary, but yeah, it was a big salary for us. So it changed us, but it was the first time living away from home, and I loved it. I've got great memories of it.
Now, your dad is an 82 All White.
He is.
Did he ever play professionally?
No. Well, he played lower leagues in England. I'm not sure it was full professional. But then when he came out here, he came out probably, I think, 30, maybe even after 30. He played until he was late 30s, won everything here. And I've watched a couple of games, and it's as far as people that are humble, geez, he doesn't really talk about it much. He just slides in games, watches my games, and slides back out again. He was on the old Bet365 getting the live footage of when I was playing a Christensen versus whatever in Norwegian second year. So he's been great, but he's been fantastic to have around and support me.
And then when you were younger, your mum was in a relationship with Chris Turner, who was the chairman of the Kings?
He founded the Kings. Yeah. He founded the Kings. So that was interesting to be part of that.
Was there any kind of like residual pressure or anything from you being a young aspiring footballer that it's Chris Turner's stepson?
Not really. It was actually the opposite. I remember looking back going, if I did do well, and I went through phases, and I think about 15, 16, I was pretty poor. I was very small. And
you didn't score a penalty past me. It's evidence of that.
Hey,
for sure.
Fun fact, my first ever senior game would have been against you at Claudelands, at that pitch with the
wow.
gates.
People helping people.
There you go.
I scored that day.
A little slice of history, Shay.
Yeah. I was probably dropped at that stage. It was early in the season.
Okay, so yeah, but that was my first ever game of senior football. I picture it perfectly. We played a youth league game not long ago there, and I could picture it, first ever game. But I think when I was involved with, obviously with Chris being so sort of a bit of a public figure in the Kings, and with what he had done before, and saving my dad with the 82 World Cup, I felt like people thought I was in the places I was because of that.
Yeah.
And that hurt me quite a lot, because I was never the greatest player, but, and I'm sure we'll go into what it was like when I was younger, but I just trained harder than anyone else. I know it sounds cliche and everything, but I genuinely, there was no one in my age group or anywhere around in New Zealand that did work harder than me. And I felt, looking back now, I felt a little bit hard done by a few people. I remember Bill McGowan, great guy, obviously. I remember we played a Kings curtain raiser, and I was 13 or 14, and I was injured that day, shock. We'll probably get to those as well. But I was up in the box with Bill, and he says, he says something like, one day you might be good enough for them, or you're too small, or something like that. And I felt like going like, no, just wait. Like, just wait. It was my age group out there. It was my age group. So I kind of felt that. That was the only negative, but obviously I got exposed to a few things. It was great. We went to Australia quite a lot, and yeah, it was good.
Chris, when I was doing research for the pod, I talked to a lot of your friends, a lot of your close friends, to see what they...
How was he?
to see what sort of guy you were growing up in your youth. And you hung around with a lot of party boys. Guys like Sam Jasper, Anthony Hagen, Stu Hogg. But what they have said is that you never drunk, and that was a big difference. You never got on the booze. You've from day one, you were always the sober driver, like you said.
That's why they were friends with me.
Yeah.
Save the money every Saturday night.
Your discipline and your sort of work ethic and drive, created the platform for the career that you had. But where did that decision to not just to stay away from booze? Did you ever drink?
No. I genuinely didn't. I don't know. My mum pushed me a lot. She probably pushed me just to that limit. She never sort of overdid it. I remember doing lines when I was 13 at the Weir Rosebowl because I didn't play well in a game.
Sorry.
I remember doing lines. The boys were playing petonk
afterwards. Different lines. Yeah, right. Okay. So you mean
that's linesman. Again, yeah. Later on.
I was thinking, wow, 13, we've really.
Oh, right. Okay.
No, I didn't drink, though.
Didn't drink. That's fair.
But I remember things like that, and she pushed me a lot, but she pushed me in the right way. But
But was there peer pressure from that group? Was, did you ever crack?
I love those guys. They're great. And I felt like there was, and then all of a sudden it stopped. At all of it, like, it would be
is that
like
because you left the country.
Yeah, it was 22, and I gave up. But it got to the point where I think I must have been around, just before the Knights, and they kind of went, you know what, like, fair play, and they'd always joke I didn't, and then it stopped. And once it stopped, it was another kind of big step for me. I didn't ever see this anymore, but once they stopped and they respected that, I thought maybe I am doing something right here. And look, those guys are great, and yeah, some talent in there, by the way. Hager was probably one of the best players in the country, I reckon, at 15.
Well, that's what I was talking to Sam Jasper about. He was like, look, we were a talented bunch.
Oh, very.
Those guys.
Hoggy
they all
as
had
well.
It.
He was ripping up the National League, wasn't he?
Hoggy was a great player when he was young. But, and you see it so often in New Zealand football, don't you? They get to those sort of late teens, early 20s, and the lure of the alcohol and the women and the drugs or whatever it is, the party lifestyle, it just derails people. And there's a few that are sort of the exceptions, and I put you and Aaron Scott in the same category, is they've always, from what I've heard, been able to just sort of sidestep that scene and just concentrate on, you know, being the best footballer they can for whatever reason. And yeah, you see the sort of results from it. It's a decade of playing professional football where the rest of us, and put myself in that same category, just turned into sort of decent Northern Premier League players.
Well, some people get away with it though. That's the thing. There are players that get away with it. But again, statistically speaking, I mean, if you do put everything into it, there's a bigger chance, obviously, of making it to a degree. And the problem was back in those days, it was very hard. The pathway was, there was no pathway. I mean, it was so hard when you're that age, 16, 17 in those days, to sort of get overseas. So what do you do? Do you continue playing National League for a little bit of money? What's the pathway? There was nothing. So now it's a lot. Now it's different. This is going to sound crazy, but I remember playing in 2008 and I was sending off, someone sent something to the club and said,
fax.
It was like, can you send me a CD of the game that you played against West Brom Reserves?
Yeah.
I heard you played quite well. So I had to get the CD from the club, print it off a couple of times and post it to a club in, I can't remember the club. That's crazy. Whereas now it's all like, I can see every single game on Huddle, whatever it may be.
So when I got my scholarship to Monmouth in New Jersey, we had to send a video, which was Dad had to have a big sort of camera down at the Napier tournament, took videos of all the games, you know, over the shoulder, and then it was on a VHS tape, and then we had to convert it to a CD, and we had to send it away, and a couple of weeks later they'd say they got it. Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
Is that how you got the scholarship?
That's how I got the scholarship.
grainy footage.
Yeah.
just looping back to the non-drinking and that group that we've kind of referenced, there is some conjecture about what really happened in the Solomon Islands. With the drinking
no, no,
by
no,
the swimming
no,
pool.
No, no,
so,
no,
look,
no,
I've,
no.
I've got a couple of versions of what happened. You were there.
Yeah.
What do you recall about this?
I was in my bed asleep preparing for the next game, probably.
Well, I've heard that you were the lookout.
okay.
Hang on, Shay, paint a picture.
Yeah,
what are we talking about?
Sorry. So a few episodes back, Gwaitha has referenced by the swimming pool. New Zealand had been eliminated, I think, by that stage.
Yeah, I think we lost to the Solomons 5-0 or something.
Yeah, lost two games, lost to Fiji and lost to right. To Solomons.
Mm-hmm.
Eliminated. A couple of the players, they're of legal age. You know, they're over 18. And they decided they might have a couple of beers by the swimming pool.
Legal adults.
Yeah, that's right. And I don't know what the team management's viewpoint on that was. The team had been eliminated.
They wouldn't remember in the state they were in.
That's not for me to say. But what some have said is that Kris Bright was acting as a lookout to see if management were around.
Wow.
Others say that he was in his room, nowhere to be seen.
And
it's one of those urban legends that no one ever really knows. But now we've got
you
here.
Let's get to the bottom of it.
You give us your version of what happened at the Solomon Kitano Mendana Hotel.
I can picture it. I can picture it perfectly. So it was on a hill, and I remember the pool was down the bottom, obviously, and there was this kind of like elevator, like a kind of a ski lift.
King Solomon Hotel. King Solomon Hotel.
Is it?
It is, yeah.
Oh, really? So yeah. You go kind of up this thing, so, and all the rooms are at the top. So the only way to get there were the staircase or that to get down. So the boys said, look, Brighty, you're not having a few. Like, how about you do us all a favor, mate, and just look out for us.
It sounds like you were the lookout.
Well, I'm sure there was someone. It might have been Sam Matthews or someone like that. I don't want to put someone else. So we were there. Now, possibly some of the staff may have made their way up or down. I think what happened was I was looking up and they came from below. And so then I thought, I've got to get out of here. Like, I've got to get out of here. So I think oh my God, oh, this is so long ago. But I picture seeing, I think, Ricky walking up the stairs and thinking, oh shit, I'm going to make it to tell the boys. And I thought, nah, I'm out. So I kind of skipped, hop, skip and a jump over the little fence up the staircase. I remember yelling out, boys, I'll see you later. Or boys, something. But then, yeah, it all kind of, yeah, but that tour there, like I remember sitting in the, I got called in. I think Clive Campbell and Stu Jacobs possibly? And I think I'd been overseas at Gillingham or something. And I remember going in there and they said, we need to see a lot more than you. I said, well, like I was up front for all the preparation. I thought I did okay. And then for the first game, we used four strikers, four different number nines. And I was on the bench and we lost 3-1. I felt like going, how can I go from number one? Guiva started ahead of me. And then they put on some kid that we didn't even know. He got on the plane. That was a preparation these days. I don't know who he was. He was a friend of someone, that kind of got in.
Sam Messam?
I thought that was coming.
It was something like, really nice. I remember just going and then with the goalkeeper coach, what was his name? The English lad.
Gould?
Sandy Davey. No, it wasn't Sandy Davey. It was, I can't remember his name, but I remember he yelled out at me one time in training. I was a scapegoat. I must have said something to someone because they hated me that tour. They said, you're weak as piss, mate. Absolute weak as piss. And just screamed at me because he was in goal. Hoggy's just, whenever he sees me, like, mate, you're weak as piss, Brighty. But
yeah, I can confirm he does say that.
Is this the tour where I've heard reports that it might have been in the same coaching setup? They said that we don't have a real number nine in the team. And then you ended up scoring a goal and celebrated by pointing
to
your shirt,
number nine,
and then got disciplined and dropped for the next game because of it. Is it?
Well, I think I scored like three against like Tahiti. It was like 10-0 or something, and I may have had a scratch or like an itch in my inner around my chest region. And
Your squad number for that?
It might have been nine. It might have been nine, but like I do, and I was an arrogant boy, a kid then, and I remember seeing Ricky was on top of the stand in the Solomon Islands, and someone else was there. They were watching from there. And I remember going, I'm the number nine. I'm the number. And I that's what I was like. It's changed a bit now. But yeah, that's again. Jesus, let's move on. Like, how are you knowing that?
It's good stuff, right?
Do our homework. All right. Well, let's get into it. So you've gone from the Knights and then you've started your overseas journey, right? How did it come about? Where did you go?
Well, I was at the Knights and I played a game against Melbourne Victory away. I came on as a sub, but I did okay. And then as we were getting on the bus, this famous Australian footballer, I won't say his name, but he came up to me and I didn't know who he was at the time and said, hey, you're not a bad player, give me a call, I'm going to get you to Belgium. Oh, brilliant. So we stayed in contact and then he said, look, come over at the end of the season and train with my guy for a month. And live. So I lived in Melbourne for a month, 5 weeks, and trained one-on-one with this guy.
How old are you at this time?
Oh, after the Knights. So 19. And so I trained with this guy for ages. Then he goes, right, I'm going to send you to Racing Genk. And at that point, they may have been Champions League or something like that at that point. Went over there, scored in a friendly, did really played well. Trained with the first team, like a couple of big names. Stephen Dufour was there. I don't know. He had a pretty good career. Went to Man City, I think, as well. Good club, did really well. So then the club came to me, a kind of like a gopher, someone on the down low, and said, look, you're signing. Like, they really want you. I was like, oh, fantastic. So they said, tomorrow they're going to take you to your apartment where everything's done. So I said, brilliant. So I called my agent in Australia and said, what's the story? He goes, yeah, basically done. We're just trying to figure out a few things. I said, cool. So next day, went to training. They picked me up after training, went to take me, put all my stuff with me. But the guy didn't speak English and he just kept driving and we're driving and driving and driving and driving. And we ended up going to the airport. And I said, well, what's going on here? And I'm calling everyone. And by that point, my agent's asleep. It's New Zealand or whatever. They gave me a piece of paper. Here's your ticket. Here's your passport. Like, I had my passport and I was on a plane. Then got to Dubai. I got to wherever. Still, and so anyway, I turned up at the airport and I called like my dad and said, Dad, I'm and obviously I wouldn't have talked to anyone for 24 hours and they all thought I was signing. Yeah. So I don't know what they were thinking. I got to the airport and said, Dad, can you come pick me up? So what I found out was, is that I would have signed for free. So I signed for something like, I signed for 40,000 euros for the season, which at that time was about 100 grand, which I was well happy with. Jeez, I was only 19. Well,
Steve loves a money question.
Yeah, I love a money question. So that means when you sign for 100 grand,
yeah,
that whole 100 grand is coming to you?
Yeah,
That's not split any more ways?
No.
Okay.
But this was the problem. Brilliant. So yeah, well, it would have been brilliant. But then I tried to call the agent for a good week, couldn't get hold of him. And this is a name, like he's done all right. Anyway, what had happened was he had asked the club for 40,000 euros for him. And remember, I'm a kid that had a couple of games in the A-League. I don't even think I scored in the A-League. Like, I'd done okay. I was like number 3 to number 4 striker, young lad they were going to invest because I had an English passport. It was easy. So 40,000 euros for him, remember 100 grand. 40,000 euros for the geezer that was coaching me, and 100,000 euros for his $100,000. Sorry, so 40,000 euros for his partner. So, the package was something like 160,000 euros for the first year, and it was a 3-year deal. So I just got another 40, and they just laughed and said. And I found out later on that they just laughed and went, "You've got to be joking! Like, we'll pay 40,000 euros, but that's it. You take your agent's cut from that." So I found that out very, very late on. But one of the teams I played against was Fortuna Sittard. And they got in contact through Frank Van Eyes because he knew I was in New Zealand, played with me, and he said, "Hey, what's this boy?" So then they brought me over, and then I signed there for a lot less than $100,000.
So Fortuna Sittard is the former home of Fred de Jong.
Yes, yes.
And how much high regard is he held at that club?
Well, they called me Fred at the start because they all knew. And Fortuna used to be a massive club, good stadium, massive, massive club. Now they're back up to where they should be. They're getting there. But yeah, they all knew Fred, and there's not many New Zealand footballers. So obviously they just and our playing style was similar. So yeah, and I spoke to Fred a few times about Fortuna and even the place and the style. So he helped me out when I first went there. But Fortuna was great. Fortuna was. I got my first start there because this Nigerian lad, Waziwo Taiwo, his name was a very good player, turned up late. And so they said, "Oh, shit, better start Brighty."
Turn up to the game or to training?
The game. Yeah, just turned up late for the game. And I'm busy.
Early.
Yeah, early. I am very early. And turned up and then they said, "Okay, start." And I kept my spot for 10, 11 games. He got released and never played again.
What sort of a player are you? At this point in your career,
what type of player am I?
Yeah, what type of player are you?
No, it's mobile.
You guys got a lot in common then.
Were you an old fashioned target man? What were your strengths?
The hard thing for me was I was tiny up until I was about 17. So I only started growing. I was tiny little whippet, step overs, all that kind of stuff, quick. And then all of a sudden, around 16, I started to grow. A very late bloomer. And so I ended up turning into an old-fashioned target man that just worked really, really hard, and I was great around the box. So I was very boring, very simple in the middle third, but I just linked up well in the final third, and I saw that's why whenever I went on trial, I seemed to do really well because coaches saw something they could use, and
How many times have you trialed versus signing?
Well, I'm just thinking. So I think I trialed at most. Well, let's just say 60% of those clubs.
But for every time you've signed at a club, how many?
I reckon I probably had.
What's the ratio of trials?
I reckon 3 trials to every contract.
Yeah.
There's been some really unlucky ones, which everyone's got those stories. And there's been some lucky ones, even in Greece. I went on trial in Greece, which they told me I was going to do a medical, and I turned up and played a game, and trained for a week, and I was rubbish, but. Greece, certain things happened and things get done. And I all of a sudden was signed in Greece. Mark and Gilberto Silva in my first game going, "What is going on here? I'm pretty sure you just won everything in the UK." And now I'm marking you at set pieces. That was interesting.
What's it like in those early years being in a foreign country? Did you have a support network? Were you just there by yourself? Did you speak the language? How was the off-field stuff?
Well, when I first left and when I went to Fortuna Sittard, I was alone a lot. And internet was obviously, it was a little bit different then. There was Skype, but I had to like go to internet cafes. That's stick me in horrible little, God, I remember one place in Fortuna City, they stuck me in a little one, there was literally the bed and that was it. And I shared a bathroom with all these other people. And then I go and play in front of like 10,000 people the next day. And I'm going like, well, this is mad. But yeah, it's, you get looked after to a degree and on these trials. But yeah, actually I forgot the question there, Stephen. I'm not going to lie.
Well, was the language a barrier?
Oh, the language, well, in certain places, yes. Holland, it wasn't because everyone spoke English. Most, in fact, yeah, you could say everyone spoke English pretty well, enough to get by. But in places like Hungary, my wife and I really, really, really struggled, like really struggled. And there was only a group of Brazilian boys that could kind of talk a bit of English. And it really harmed me in certain countries. But for the best part, they could speak English.
So I'm just looking at your fact sheet here. Mm-hmm. And so from, it seems from 2006 to 2009, you bounced around from Fortuna Sittard to Kristiansand in Norway to Panserraikos in Greece and to Shrewsbury Town. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of countries and a lot of clubs in a four-year span. So what's going on over that period? Are you signing one-year contracts and then not getting them renewed, or how does that all work?
They all differ. So Fortuna, I signed 1 year. I had a really bad knee injury that was misdiagnosed. In fact, it wasn't a bad knee injury, and it just kept me out for 4 or 5 months, but they misdiagnosed me. I ended up paying myself to go to Belgium, which was only 5 minutes around the corner, to get it fixed. And then they said, come back in pre-season. If you pass the fitness test, we'll exercise your option contract, so your extra year, which I had agreed to.
It's
so
one then, plus one, they call it in the business.
Okay.
It's a one plus one, correct. So came back and I won the fitness testing. I was always the fittest. But they changed coaches, that old chestnut, and they said, oh, look, you're going to be number four striker, so we'll take up your option, but you're never going to play. I was like, oh, forget it. So that's when I went to Norway. And in Norway, there was 11 games to go in the season. We were pushing for promotion. So I signed and I thought, you know what? And it was an okay level. It was pretty good. But I went in there in 8 games. I scored 11. And so this is where my life could have been a lot different. This is one of the sad points I feel like in my career. Everyone's got those stories of, oh, I got injured and I wouldn't have been playing for this. But because I scored so many goals and I had a little bit of a profile, a lot of teams were watching, and I was playing against the reserve team of one or two teams, and I scored so many. And I had a 3-year deal agreed with a team called Starbeck, which has been up and down. But at that point, I think they're in the Champions League in the same group as Liverpool. So they'd been talking to me about signing and being number three striker, that two Brazilian lads up front, or Swedish born Brazilian. And sweet. So I was due to fly up there again to meet with them, but we had a game on the Monday against their second team, funnily enough.
In the league, or just the,
it might have been the league, because it's like in Germany you play that.
It's like the old Northern League where Claudelands played North Shore United reserves, that sort of thing.
Something
very
like
similar,
that, yeah.
Very similar.
So what happened was, in that game, so I was flying, like confidence was sky high. I think I hit the crossbar, hit the post after 20 minutes, and then basically I broke my leg. Went to hold it up, defender clipped me by accident, fell on me, a fibula snap. And it was a big stadium, but there weren't that many people there. But the chairman of the club that I was at and the chairman of the club that was signing me heard the snap, and they quickly insured me. My own club quickly called up, insured me, and the guy was like, look, that's game over. So went and had surgery. My club, Kristiansand, were fantastic. They could claim it all back through insurance and all that. So they signed me on a 2.5-year contract. Because wow. They knew they would sell me back, and they put like a really small clause in. It was only like $100,000 to buy me out, which was nothing then for these clubs. And then that was it. And then I got to 1 year, and then the club had some financial difficulties, and I asked to get released because this team in Greece were interested, and then I flew out.
So when you've broken your leg, how long are you looking at?
It wasn't that
out of action.
It was brilliant because I only missed 2 games. There was 2 games to go in the Norwegian season.
Oh, right.
Because it was, so then they said, you know what they said? They said, go back to New Zealand and we'll see you when we see you. I said, what do you mean? I said, well, look, if you're out of the country, they paid me in full, and I came back and stayed here until March. February, March, was working with Roland Netter every day. And that is how I met my wife.
I was going to ask about that because you've referenced her a couple of times already. So
I have to, because she'll probably listen, won't she?
Well, I hope so. And I hope we spread through her friends and family network as well. But
probably emphasis on friends, but yeah.
How much of a support has she been through this journey? And did she come straight over back with you to Norway? How did that all kind of pan out?
No, we met and we were together for a very short amount of time, like a very short amount of time while I was back rehabbing. And
little,
then
little Greece summer loving.
Well, no, I loved her then, Seamus, when I met her, but then we just fell apart because I had to get...
I knew you should have eaten before.
I haven't eaten. I'm done.
She's gone.
I might sit
the next few out.
Yeah.
So she was working in Meccano in Glenfield by Rolly's physio, and I'd go shopping. And I'd go get treatment from Rolly. And yeah, I remember saying to Rolly, like, there's this girl, should I ask her out? Like, I was kind of half seeing a girl in Holland at that time anyway. But then I said, look, should I say? And he goes, you know what, go for it. So the next day I went back in, asked her out. And then 2 years later, Facebook happened. Jeez, I'm old.
It's okay.
Jesus.
This is a safe space.
And then she messaged me. And then she goes, oh, look, oh, there's this Facebook thing. She found me. She messaged me. And then I met her, I came back, obviously, I think after the Confederations Cup, we met, and she's never left. I mean, I've never wanted her to leave, and she stayed with me.
Yeah. So that's a difficult situation to buy into, being the partner of someone who's travelling around all these clubs trying to get a professional contract. Did she buy into that?
She had no idea about football. Her mum's from Southampton, so she used to sort of go watch the game. So she had a rough idea about football, and it kind of got to the point where when we met, I was in Greece, and then I went to Shrewsbury from there. And once that happened, which was only in about a month time, I said, look, why don't you come over? And she was like, oh, you know what? Yeah, I will. So she had no idea. And she turned up to the first game, and there's like maybe 8,000 people there, like close League Two football, really small stadium, but loads of people, and they're screaming, like they're singing always look on the bright side of life. And she's like, oh my God, what is this? And it's funny with people, and same with my family, they're like, what do you do? And I'm like, oh, okay, I play football. Well, no, what else do you do? So there's that element. People think I play football, and then there was, what else do you do? Or there's, oh my God, you play football, you're a multimillionaire.
Yeah.
There's no in between. There's no in between. So she was like, well, what else do you do? And then the mum kind of explained. So then she understood. But she's been brilliant. I mean, we're speaking to David Brown about, he's just gone over to Finland, and he's got his Dutch girlfriend. He's asking, look, how does it work? And I mean, we had some really, really tough times in some countries where she had no friends, like New Zealand and places like that. No, but she, she's been brilliant. She followed me everywhere.
So what do you do in your downtime when you're in these countries and you're trained for, I assume, a few hours a day? What do you do with the rest of your time?
I don't know. Now that I've got a kid, I'm non-stop now. I don't know what I did. I don't know. Just nothing. You go to the movies, you go over lunch, you play mini golf, just float around. Really, I think I should have done more with the education side. I did like a nutrition degree and all that. There's a few things here and there, but one problem I did get into, and no one, I don't even think I told my wife this, but it's like when Ting said, when I got into a bit of money, especially in Greece, where you got paid sort of in brown paper bags, I didn't know what to do with it. And I'm kind of like, well, what do I do? It was, I'd come into this quite a bit of money, and I started gambling a bit. Obviously, I didn't have I'm an addict to football, addict to training, and I've got like an addictive personality. And I don't know, so I got addicted to gambling. And I remember going on a tour with the All Whites. We were in Botswana. Vasilich and I were talking about this the other day, and Vasilich and I were in a casino in Botswana, or Tanzania maybe, I think it was Botswana, and I'm like throwing it down. And it was just me and Vis, just at like midday, and he's like, Brighty, like, you okay? Like, well, after like a couple of days of this, he's like, look, Brighty, how about you rein this in a bit? And that's when I thought, you know what, maybe I should rein it in. And I stopped, and luckily it was good. But for 6 months, when you do get into a bit of money and you never had money before, it was tough.
It's dangerous. It's a slippery slope. It's if it was only 6 months, you're lucky you sort of got out then, and you sort of kicked the habit or stopped it turning into a habit.
Yeah, and then I've not done it since. Yeah, no gambling, no nothing since.
Well, thanks for sharing that. I imagine you might not have told that many people, but it's things like that. And I think that comes from perhaps the isolation, the foreign country, the difficult environment, not a certain future, and it sort of comes out in different ways, and you need to find a vice. Mm. You're not drinking, it comes out.
There was no one to talk to. I remember my roommate was, I think he was captain of the Slovenian team. It was at the World Cup or the Euros maybe. I'm not sure. I think he might have been captain of the World Cup. He was smoking away. Like we'd stay in the hotel the night before every game, even a home game. There's women coming in, like literally lining up. I'm a kid from Manurewa going like, just play for Fortuna, sit down, a bit of this, a bit of that. And now all of a sudden, this is crazy. So that's why I try and help as many young kids as I can here. Like, obviously, I'm not sure how many push on, but to understand that even like Kalamakawa and Tiarifai, like they wouldn't have earned this money. I know it's not massive money, but they need people kind of looking after them. Same with South Africa. The money in South Africa is ridiculous. But I tell you what, in South Africa, we had boys that if they got paid 100 grand a year, they would spend $100,000 the year in that year. That's it. So by the end of it, there was a guy that came that was training with us. He'd won the league 7 times. Now, I'd say the bonus of winning the league would be probably 50 grand or something stupid like that. He was living out of his car. And it's that education that these kids need and players need it. But I didn't really have that. But lucky enough, the money dried up. I didn't have a choice.
You talk about South Africa, and we have New Zealand has a few players that are there at the moment. Brocky was, I think, with you, one of the trailblazers. We've got Andre de Jong there now. Mm-hmm. Dan Morgan's there.
Mm-hmm.
We've actually had a couple bounce back out of there. So Emilio Tade's back at Auckland City. Mike mm-hmm. Elialaf is actually, I don't want to date this podcast, but he's in Auckland tonight on his way back to the Solomon Islands after having his contract terminated. What's that like to play football in South Africa?
It was mad. Our team was, even though they were quite successful, normally sort of top, you call them top three or four, but we didn't have a huge fan base like Brocky and Tade's team had Sundowns. I mean, I was speaking to Tade about it. He struggled because here he's essentially no one. He could go to Countdown without knowing. You can't go anywhere in South Africa without people. And the same with Brocky. And him being white in South Africa, even a friend of mine, it was him seeing at my wedding. He's a white South African playing in that league. Now, he cannot go anywhere. Everybody knows him. The police stop you.
Really? Brocky tries to go to the supermarket. What's happening?
Well, I think probably Jess is going. I think his wife's probably going. But I think if he was to go, if he goes, everyone knows Jeremy Brocky.
So he would get swamped for autographs.
He'd go to a cafe. Jeremy, hey, how are you? Can you sign?
Yeah.
It's like it's the big thing over there. They don't. There's rugby, but there's football. So when there's football, there's, you know, you're a bit of a star. I think that's what Tade struggled with. But it's a ruthless environment. I mean, obviously Micah as well. Micah was doing all right, and now he's back here. Tade for different reasons, but yeah, it's a ruthless environment though in South Africa.
Here's something I had a friend visit recently, and I'm kind of embarrassed to say this. I had this perception in my mind that South Africa was mostly white.
No, but it's not.
And she's a German girl.
Mm-hmm.
And she was there, and she was like, yeah, there's black people everywhere. And I was thinking, nah, it can't be. It's the other way around. And then I was showing my naivety because I've never travelled there before. But yeah, what's that like?
Well, I think even in the football team, we had, in my team, three. I think in Brocky's team, there's probably three. Some teams there's none. Most teams there's none. So there's not many white footballers. It's a black sport. That's what they say. I mean, obviously you say that here, you can't, but over there, that's what it is. So, but in general, yeah, I mean, it's South Africa.
So was there any racial bias? Was being white or black seen as an advantage or a disadvantage?
I'm not sure it was seen as an advantage or a disadvantage, but I mean, what happened with me after my stint in Bidvest Fits, I got fit again and I was trialing with a team and they said, oh, look, come on in then. And played one game, like just loads of trialists. There was probably about 40 trialists that turned up for 3 days, and like I banged in goals. There were some rubbish players, but I banged in goals left, right, and centre, and they said, right, we'll take you on pre-season tour. Went on pre-season tour, scored another hat-trick in the first game there, and all the boys were like, look, you're going to be signed. So I said, I went in to the chairman's office, look, what's the story? Oh, we're going to take you on pre-season tour, and we'll decide. I said, look, mate, I've banged in goals. It's been here like 10 days. No. So I went on pre-season tour, Like I say, scored three in the first one, scored again. And it was quite obvious that I was going to be a good player for the team. Anyway, they kept me on. And finally, we got back to the place where this club is. And I went to the chairman's office and said, look, hey, this is getting out of hand now. Like, obviously, I'm going to be one of your better players. Can we sort something out? I'll get my agent to come in. And he said to me, and I'll never, ever forget this. I can picture the office and everything, and it's crazy. He said to me, we'd love to have you. He goes, and this is a Jewish guy. He's a Jewish guy. And he said to me, unfortunately, you're the wrong colour to play for this club. I said, and I kind of half laughed. I was like, well, what are you talking about? Let's just get this done. Because he'd been quite friendly. Mm. You're white. We've already got two. We don't need a third one.
Wow.
And I said, well, hey, and I kind of was just in shock. I said, mate, the other two are rubbish. So get rid of one of them. Obviously, I'm banging in goals for fun here. And I really, really, really wanted to stay at this club. Like, it was good for my wife. She loved it in South Africa. She's from Malawi, so she had a lot of family kind of close by, a lot of close friends.
Do you know where that's coming from? Is that a thing that they think would get the fans offside? Or is it a team harmony?
Is there a quota like they kind of had in rugby for a little while?
No. It's just certain teams. I'd never heard of that, and it wasn't at Bidvest. It was nothing like that.
Do you think it's from like the owners not wanting it?
He was the owner.
So it was just his decision.
I have no idea. And I walked out of there, and it was embarrassing because the two coaches kind of, I went to shake their hands, and they kind of like put their head down. They knew, and so I don't know. And that stuck with me, and I really struggled going home to my wife and saying, look, we're going to have to leave here. Because then I had an offer from Northern Ireland, and I was like, if it doesn't work out of this club, we're going to go. And that was a real shame. That stuck with me. There's many things that stuck with me in my career, and that was one of them. That it was just a big shock.
Mm. Are you still close with Jeremy Brockie?
Yesterday, funny enough, we didn't talk for a few months, but we were very, very close over there. There was myself, Michael Boxall.
That's right. I forgot Boxall.
Osaka Cernak. Do you guys know Cernak?
Yeah.
Yeah, Cernak played over here. We were really close. And
do you think Brockie's success in South Africa? I actually saw a really quite revealing Instagram post from him the other day talking about, you know, he scored a first goal, and despite what people think, he's really sort of struggling at times, and it was great to get on the scoreboard. Do you think his career in South Africa has exceeded his expectations?
He'd done all right at the Phoenix before he left. So I think obviously he moved there thinking there were positives, and he went over there and he blew up. Now, if you blow up and the thing in South Africa is no one scores goals. So if you go to South Africa and you score goals, you're done. So Brocky would have a great 6 months, and then bang, new contract. Like, we're laughing. He could have a bad 6 months, but they don't think about that. They just remember that good 6 months. Mm. And he loves it over there. I'd be very surprised if he comes back anytime soon. I actually said to him the other day, funnily enough, I said, you just stay there. Do not come back. Do not go anywhere. You stay there. You're 32, 33 now. Just stay. Mm. Because it's setting him up for life. His family loves it. He's done very well.
Mm. When you were sort of leaving South Africa, you're sort of late 20s, mid-20s, whatever you were. Did you think there was a ceiling on your career? Did you kind of know the level that you were capable of playing at, or did you still have ambitions of playing at the top level?
So I it's really funny you say that. I feel kind of like goosebumps when you say that, because there was one turning point. My wife doesn't even know this, and my wife was there this day. So when I was in South Africa, I thought, right, I'm back on track here. I'd gone to India. I went there for the money. I went there for a new experience, and I thought, if I do well there, there's a lot of money there. And I thought, well, if I'm going there, I'm finished in Europe. However, my career's not finished. I can keep being a professional and earn a good living from the game. But then I got a gig. Then when I got this gig in South Africa, again, good contract, good facilities, because the World Cup had been there, so the facilities were amazing. Great level. I thought, yeah, I do well here. I could stay here for the rest of my career. Scored on debut. They thought, geez, this is like the new Jeremy Brockie, this new New Zealand boy's kind of founder. They sent me to all the TV shows, radio, all this stuff. I'd only played two games and scored one, but I was like the new guy. And I talked well on TV for them, so they were making me a poster boy. Then in a friendly game before we played Chiefs, which is going to be maybe 20,000 people there or whatever, We played a friendly game and I kind of went in for a 50-50 and the lad went over the ball and my knee I'd never had any knee problems really before. And I knew something was seriously wrong. And I went down, I tried to get back up. My knee just felt like all loose. And they tried to get me back on the pitch. Nah. So I went inside and I was just in tears. And I didn't cry for ages and I was just in tears by myself and I thought something was seriously wrong. Anyway, they said, no, you're all good. 3 weeks, you'll be back. And I was like, great, fantastic. Get me back out there. 3 weeks, my knee is huge. They're giving me injections every day. They're draining. My knee was huge. I got videos. Just draining 3 minutes of draining fluids from my knee and sending me on the rower. So I thought, no, something is not right here. But I remember after 3 weeks and blowing up, I went and I had a shower at home during the day after training. I came home from training. I was having a normally long shower, even for me. And the missus got to the point where she's going, look, are you okay? And I remember being in there just crying. I was just crying. I was crying my eyes out. And I was like, oh, this is me. Like, I know deep down that my knee is not right. And I've never had a knee problem. And people's careers are finished by knee injuries. And I was just in cry. I remember sitting there like head, but it was like a woman movie, just sitting there. I can picture it. And I get kind of sad thinking about it, to be honest. But I thought like, I pictured all the stuff that I'd done, all the hard work when I was a kid. I remember even when I was at St. Peter's, I would kick a ball against the wall. I'd have a raffle. So I had all these different exercises. I'd run to my primary school. That would be on one piece of paper. The other piece of paper would be juggle 1,000 times before I go to school. All these different things. And I remember just sitting there thinking about all this hard work and I'm going, this is me finished.
And how old are you at this point?
Since it's the end of Bid vs West, so I would have been, I don't know, check the Wikipedia. I don't have a clue.
2015, 16.
It would have been
right?
Probably only 5 years ago, okay. 4 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably 4 years ago.
Was that, are you talking about the acceptance that this was so serious that
I thought there's no way I'm coming back.
You weren't ever going to be the player that you were before this injury?
No, and that's when it hit me and I thought, I'm done. I am completely done. So Mrs. didn't talk to me for like a day. She just left me alone and I went and got my own doctors. When I paid for my own scans, it was so expensive. I think I lost a month's salary just in trying to fix and find the problem. The day they found out, the day I found out that I tore my, or partially tore my ACL, it was amongst loads of other stuff because they didn't scan me. I went to my wife's work because she just started work there, and I went up to her and I was in the car park and I couldn't get out of the car again. I was just in tears and I couldn't get out of the car park. And finally, I called her from the car park again. She probably doesn't know this. I called her from the car park and I said, like, I'm finished. Like, I'm done. Like, that's it. We're done. We're going home. Like, I'm not playing football again. Like, we've done my ACL, this and the other. So, then the club, within an hour, found out, sort of said, don't come back to the club. Like, I went from this poster boy to no one. Then they struggled after 6 months, and I was training myself every day. I was going in at, like, 4 p.m. to the club on the side pitches, training myself, paying for And then I got myself kind of right-ish. I knew myself I was finished. I knew myself. But then the coaches saw me training by myself, asked me to come back in. The club said no. The people
how
above.
How were you that certain that you were finished and that wasn't something you
Because
come back
I think
from?
It was a bit of a moment where I was like, look, I always thought I'd play for Man United. I thought, shoes were down. League 2, yeah, I'd do all right. I'll go up. Greece Super League, yeah, I'll play a couple of games and I'll go for Panathinaikos. We bet Panathinaikos. I'm thinking I could play against these. Play for these and all that. So in my mind, I was so obsessed that I thought, no, I'm going to keep going. And that's and even when I was in India, I still thought I could keep going. But no, that was, it got to the point where I was like, no. All the times people had said to me, like, you're not going to play any higher. I was like, yeah, they're right. And they're right. I think if you look after South Africa, I went to Linfield. I struggled. I just couldn't get right. And you know when I was at my peak, the last 10 years I was at my peak fitness in the National League final for Auckland City because I got injured in the second game of before the second game of the season.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
So I scored against Jose in Wellington. I was the difference, although we lost 3-1. Defective shot, but it was quite an infamous goal. I think that was probably one of the last games Auckland City's lost in the league and I played in that. But yeah, I got injured and I came back from that. I had another niggling injury and I've got that thing now where I'm the injured guy. But I worked my bollocks off. Like, and there were a couple of people at the club, but I love, like, friends of mine, they were like joking. Like, so I got the fittest. I was training before training at Auckland Grammar. I was training at 5 a.m. I'd go and coach Auckland Grammar. I'd then go home. I'd train again. I'd go home. I'd go to Auckland City training. I never told anyone about what I was doing. I got ripped to fuck. Like, oh my God. Like, I got really ripped. I got really strong. Got really fit. And then, and then I think the last kick of the O-League semi-final, I went for a volley, got deflected just in front of me and pulled my groin. The last kick of my career finished.
Oh, God.
And the last kick, actually, there's a photo of it, me, like, wincing on the ground, and I think I had to get carried off.
Yeah.
And then that was me. And then Three Kings asked me to come in, and once I was right. And,
so, but before Auckland, and you've had this horror injury, but you still went to Ireland.
Yeah.
So in your head, you're knowing that you're not the player that you once were, but you're still trying to eke out a career.
I knew I wasn't going to play in the Premier League, but I thought I'm going to go to Ireland, in Northern Ireland, and I'm at the best club, and I'm going to stay in the UK for as long as possible because I loved the UK, and it just didn't work. Like, we would train at night. I've never trained at night, and sometimes we'd train at night, and I don't know. We had a couple of boys that worked. I had no idea. So we trained a couple of times in the morning, a couple of times at night. And I just could not get used to it. I bought a shitbox of a house. I was like building, renovated a house. I made more money from the house than what I did playing for Linfield, funnily enough. But I was fine to play. I was fit, but I wasn't the same player. I wasn't as strong. Like, I was still scared of certain things. But look, I passed medicals. I was fine, but just deep down, I knew.
So you're back in New Zealand after you've tore your groin in the semi-final.
Yes.
You've got yourself in the best shape of your career in the last 10
years.
Yeah,
I was in great nick.
Why did you close the book then?
I think you're asking the wrong person. I think Auckland City may have retired me themselves. I don't think I've ever actually announced my retirement.
Okay.
You know what? I just, for all those listeners out there, I think of might actually retire. So I wanted to play again, and I was actually doing my coaching license over in the UK, and I was speaking to Vucelic and going, I was speaking to Ramon, kind of going, look, can I? They wanted me to coach the youth league, and I didn't put two and two together. I didn't think, hang on, how can I coach the youth league and still play? Never. I didn't think, and I remember speaking with Vucelic going, like, no, like, it's going to be tough. So no, and then they basically said, look, you're going to coach the youth league.
Mm-hmm.
And then I could have gone to like Waitakere or Tasman or some. But look, once you're in Auckland City and you know what it's like, and you know what Ramon was like, and you know what Jose's like, there's no comparison. There's no comparison to the level. There's no comparison to the way a club is run. It's a professional club. That club there is more professional, is run more professionally than some of the clubs on that list there that have players on buckets of money and all sorts. And we're an amateur club. So I didn't want to go anywhere else. I didn't want to play. And you know what else? And I've said this to quite a few people. I didn't want to continue playing and not be good. Yeah. I wanted to be good. I wanted to be the guy that trained really, really hard and was good and scored goals. But I again knew that if I'm going to play at 32, I could play in the Winter League. No, I could play in the National League, no problem. But how good would I be? And I didn't think I didn't like being unsuccessful, and I thought, well, I'm going to be the best goddamn coach I could possibly be, and I'm going to put all my time and effort into that. And that's what's happened.
So was coaching on your radar when you were playing? You mentioned you did some stuff in the UK, but was that something that you'd always aspired to do post playing?
I think I kind of fell into it because I always seemed to give advice to younger players. At different clubs, I'd take the strikers away and do extra sessions with strikers, and I would only be 23, 24, because I was working myself, and I'd use them, and then we'd coach, and then just slowly got into it. And then when I was in the UK, in Northern Ireland, lucky enough, they had a UEFA B. License there, so one of the players was helping run it, and I was like, okay, so I jumped on that, not knowing that of the 24 players I probably had the 23rd worst career out of everyone. It was honestly like a who's who. It was embarrassing. I turned up, the first person I met was Stylian Petrov. Like, okay, there's what, 300 Premier League games. Then there's a guy who couldn't speak amazing English. He'd won the Europa League with Porto, or Champions League even, and there was Phil Barsley, like all these boys, and I'm going like, who the, so then all of a sudden I got a real taste for it. I got a real taste for it once when I was doing my license. I thought, yeah, this is what I, if I'm not going to be the best footballer, I'm going to be the best coach, and I've done a lot of coaching since then.
Leading up to that, as you're basically after you had that terrible injury, how much thought are you putting into life after football? Was there ever, I know you're doing a lot of coaching now and you're basically a full-time coach, was there any ever thought to do something outside of football?
There was the thought, but the application wasn't quite there, and the problem is now, and again, I'm really, really struggling. I'm not struggling as much as what I was when I first started coaching, because coaching in New Zealand doesn't pay. Well, it pays, but I'm not exactly rolling in cash.
How many teams are you coaching at the moment?
Oh, I'm coaching Dyson Girls School, First 11. Love that. Absolutely love that. Auckland Grammar, Director of Football and First 11 Head Coach. Again, I love that as well. It's fantastic. So I look after 430 kids there. Central First Team and Reserves, looking at that as well. And then the Academy pathway with the 13s and 40s, sort of overlooking the Academy with Jose and Nick Downs and Ivan Vasilic. So I'm doing a lot.
So essentially four coaching jobs.
And then the National Youth
League? Well, then the National Youth League as well. So that took me from September to December, plus, yeah, loads of different other little tiny roles here and there. So, I'm doing a lot. But I have to, and what's lucky is a lot of other coaches in the country have to work their way up to the central. I mean, we came second in national tournament and second in Auckland for Auckland Grammar, one of the biggest schools in New Zealand. So I'm nearly I feel like I'm at the best school for football in New Zealand. And then I'm at Central, one of the best winter league clubs. I'm coaching, I'm going to have 10 Auckland City players from May onwards. So I'm working with Tade, I'm working with Cam Howson, I'm working with, so I'm lucky. Dyer, we came fourth in all, so I'm at the top of what I feel like I can do within my certain roles. However, there's obviously only a few roles that are above what I'm doing now in New Zealand and in Auckland.
Yeah, you mentioned your grammar stuff. Are you a grammar old boy?
I went to St. Peter's. I went to St. Peter's from Form 1 to Form 2. And then I went to Auckland Grammar, and I left in sixth form when I was also told by the coach there that I'd never be a professional footballer, and that's because I said, why am I not in the first 11? That kicked me on as well, and I saw him about 3 years later when I'd had a good contract, and I felt very good about myself to go, basically.
Did you play for the first 11?
Never play for the first 11. And after the second interview for Auckland Grammar, they went, hey, Chris, like, you know, we really think you're great and stuff, but we've gone through the records.
Why didn't you play for us?
Are you sure you played for New Zealand? Like, you didn't play for the first 11. We've walked around the hall looking at team photos. You're not there. Oh, I wasn't there. And I thought, oh, you know what? I'm not getting this now. I'm not getting the role now. So I was open and honest and told them what happened. And that's when I went to Gillingham. So I left. I didn't do seventh form, or year 13, as they say now. I went to Gillingham. But
you didn't make the first 11 in sixth form?
No. They said to me at the start of the season they didn't think I was good enough. So I was like, you know what, screw you. And I went and played for the mighty North Shore Rovers reserves with...
North Shore Rovers?
North Shore Rovers. Against
you played rugby, did you?
So, yeah, that's kind
of... So where do you stand then on the school versus club debate, because it's
a
lively one.
A 2-hour meeting today about that, and the hardest thing for me is that
it was Stu Hogg?
Yes.
You know what? I met Stu last week because Auckland City and St. Peter's were trying to work on certain things, and same with Auckland Grammar. Some schools aren't approachable, some are. I think it's not the school's fault, it's not the club's fault, it's not the player's fault. I think it's a collective fault of the way that football is in New Zealand. Because my program at Grammar, so I feel like I'm an okay coach. I feel like my sessions, I take them seriously. I've got three sessions a week plus a game. I think the environment that I create at my Auckland Grammar First 11 program is fantastic and better than a lot of club environments. So in that sense, in the environment that you're in, I feel like you've got, that's the most important thing. Whether it's club or school, the environment you're in. The problem comes when some clubs say, you cannot play for school, you must play for club. Like, there's a club in Auckland now that sent an email out to all the parents of every player and said, school is for education, we are the best at developing players, do not play for school. And then that, and now there's a big, so, but at third and fourth form, the kids want to play with their mates. They want to play football, but they want to integrate into the school. Yep. Now, what I'm doing at Auckland Grammar is I say to the third and fourth form is, hey, in fact, I say to everyone, you do what you want. I've never said to any player, you have to play club, you have to play school. But my environment is enough to be a good footballer, to develop as a footballer, I feel. If you want to do club as well, then the loading comes in, the loading problem. So at Auckland City, we're trying to talk to clubs going, look, so we've got a couple of boys in the Auckland City under 13s that are at Auckland Grammar. They may only do one session a week with school, three with Auckland City. So it's, oh, look, we could talk all day about this. Imagine if Hoggy got involved in this, and I'm sure he'd be writing in the comments going crazy. But I think...
Friend of the show?
Friend of the show?
I don't know. Well, we can say friend of the show. Sometimes friend, sometimes not friend.
Can we talk your international career?
Oh, yeah, we can cover that pretty quickly.
Well, you played for New Zealand.
I went on so many tours.
You played five caps,
I think. Well, technically six, because I remember one game I didn't play, but Clapham went on.
You can't count it. I'm not giving it to you.
Aaron Clapham went on. And
talk
obviously,
to Tinks about that. If you didn't get on, you didn't get a cap. That's all fair.
Tinks would love that. But there was one game, we went on tour somewhere, I can't remember where it was. I think it was Saudi Arabia or someone, and Clapham went on the pitch, but on the bottom it said Kris Bright, and on the official team sheet it said Kris Bright played. So technically I played six.
Okay. Well, the majority were in the 2008-2009 period, and you mentioned earlier you did go to the Confeds Cup. What's that like as an experience?
Oh, that was brilliant. And I loved the mahalo of my career was always when I was involved with the New Zealand team, because I was away for 12 years. Like I said, when I came back and I'd see random people, see everyone, hey, how are you, whatever. But I didn't feel like a Kiwi. I felt more English than Kiwi at times, because I would always, in the off season, go to England to see my family or whatever it may be. So whenever I was in that New Zealand environment, it was amazing. I loved every minute. I get boys to bring me some, you know, different chocolates and this, that, and the other and whatever. And it was brilliant. Confeds Cup was amazing.
Cream eggs?
Loved a cream egg. Seamus, thoughts? On a cream egg?
Yeah, no, I enjoy a cream egg, but not as much. I think you nearly bought Sainsbury's out of a cream egg.
Oh my God.
One stage in the UK.
It's gone with the research.
All right, any truth to that?
Shout out to Joel Matthews. I was living, and this is the thing, look, sometimes that piece of paper looks great like a career, but I was on Joel Matthews' couch for probably about a month, thanks to Claire and Joel for having that. But yeah, I mean, during the day, sometimes I'd sit there and have 12 cream eggs. I didn't drink, but by God, I had a lot of chocolate.
We've all got our vices.
Wow.
So at the Confeds Cup,
yeah.
Did you get any game time? Were you close? Yeah, were you a wider squad?
Hey, I played against Spain, and that was ridiculous. That's the highlight. And
had they applied the mercy rule by that stage?
Oh, it was heartbreaking. I think Boyens had a... Oh, jeez, I probably shouldn't slag off Boyens right now, but...
Well, he's a powerful man.
He's a very powerful man.
I think the pictures speak for themselves. I don't think you need to see anything.
I remember Boyens, I think, swinging a miss, and then Torres goes, oh, yeah, sweet. Oh, thanks for that, Andy. I'll take this one in. But we remember going on the bench going, oh, my God. I think Brock's got dragged after 30 as well. It was, oh, my God. But I got on, and I caught the ball about just inside our own half. Simon Allen and I played a little 1-2. I'm facing forward. I thought, you know what? Fuck it. I'm going for it here, lads. There was Pulio in front of me. I think Alonso was alongside me. It was mental. Like, it was like name after name. So I thought, you know, fuck it. So I went for it. Skip past one. And it kind of opened up. There's so many people to beat. And I skipped it past Pulio. And Alonso just nipped in and got it. But like, to me, it looked amazing. And watching it back, like, it didn't look anything like what I'm describing. Like, this actually didn't happen. But yeah, this is what I thought happened. And on the way home on the bus, I remember speaking to Stephen Olden, Brock's going, look, this could have been. I was so close to making it 5-1, lads.
And who'd have thought 8 years later you'd be doing the same down at Te Awamutu?
Yeah, Te Awamutu.
So you don't make the World Cup squad, though. Are you in the mix? What's happened there?
Yeah, so I was in the mix. So Rory's killed me. So Rory decided he wanted to play for New Zealand. I love Rory. Rory Fallon, top guy, lovely guy. But he was playing. He'd not played for New Zealand at all. And then so I was basically number four. There was Killy, Smelty, and Woodsy, and I was the number four. They'd done very well, and I think Woodsy was only 17, 18, but doing well. And I was in the Max Confeds Cup, and then Rory came back and did what he did, which pushed me down the pecking order. Now, Killy had an injury leading up to in the camp, so I think they could change the team squad. You probably know this. They could change the squad officially right up to the first game, I thought.
24 hours before the... your team's first match.
Oh, thanks, Seamus.
There you go. Well, this guy, well, we pay him the big bucks here between two beers. Yeah.
Thanks for your input tonight. So Ricky's on the phone to me going, look, Killy's got a calf strain. Look after yourself. But at the same time, at the last 2 months of the season in Shrewsbury, I just got into the team 2 months ago in the season. I got into a fight in the preseason in a reserve game, rough and tumble, down rumbling. I went to the showers. I couldn't take my shirt off. So I'd done my shoulder. So they were giving me injections, pills, everything to get me by the end of the season. So they said, right, surgery's on this date. And I went, whoa, I got a World Cup here. Like, no, we're delaying surgery until after the World Cup. And again, so Ricky's like, wait. And then didn't talk to me. I'm waiting in Shrewsbury. And then they named the team on the bloody radio. So obviously they would have called the boys first, but they didn't tell the boys that they weren't in. So I'm sitting outside in the freezing cold at 2 a.m. in Shrewsbury with big jackets on, listening to Radio Sport or whatever it may be.
In your mind, what percentage do you think that you're getting named?
Probably about 5 to 10%. Seriously, which is quite high, really, considering the situation. And
that's painful, isn't it? There's a glimmer of a hope.
I can remember sitting out. I can picture the exact seat, and I was just going, "Oh my God, this is World Cup." And So then next day I called the club and said, hey, book in the surgery. I'm not going to the World Cup. No, it's not booked till August. I'm like, So what I do, came back in, new coach. This guy's not going to be ready until after pre-season. You're down the pecking order. We've signed 3 strikers. I did my surgery, came back. I was number 4. So then I played like a couple of games, I think. And then that was me.
What was your relationship with Ricky throughout your career?
Good. Good.
Because he's recalled you, hasn't he? You've sort of three years in the wilderness and then you come back in 2013.
Yeah, I will always be grateful to Ricky because he gave me my first game as a New Zealander, as an All White.
Did you play in the infamous dead rubber game in Fiji?
There's no such thing as a dead rubber, Seamus. Every game means enough to... You've got the fern on your shirt, Seamus. You should know about that.
Well, I shouldn't. I never played for my country. I'm just like Cole Tinkler.
You got close, you got close though, didn't you? Well,
I don't want to talk about my passport times, issues.
Oh, wow. So, I did play in that. I think that was that the game that Mossy?
It is the very same. That's why I said infamous. Quite often I'm quoted on this podcast as saying either famous or infamous, but that one is valid.
Yeah,
I felt bad for Mossy. We'll allow it. That was bad for Mossy, that game. I think Greg Draper started ahead of me that game.
Let's talk about Drapes.
See, I don't know Drapes that well.
Let's talk about Drapes, baby.
So that was his one and only appearance for New Zealand.
Infamous appearance. Can we say that?
Yeah, we can.
I can use that? You say it.
Yeah.
We'll cut it on the infamous afternoon. You can use it. Okay, cool.
But he's almost the opposite of you and carved a pretty, almost the same duration professional career, but almost at just the one club, or he had a couple of clubs to begin with, but he's Ledge at the New Saints in Wales.
Yeah. That's a good club. And that's the thing. He bounced around for a while and then he got to a good club, successful club, obviously like by far and away the best club in that league. And he's comfortable and he's done very well there. And I don't see why I'd ever want to come back. Just banging on goals, winning leagues, getting golden boots.
But playing for the national team, do you think players like Drapes, players like yourself, maybe a player like Kane Vincent, they warranted more national team appearances?
I think at the time of each game, if you're taking four strikers.
It's a very PC answer, this. I can already.
I think the coach is right, whoever he picks, Seamus. But I just think at that point in time, whoever it may be, I think if Drapes goes and gets 20 goals in 6 games, does that warrant him playing in March against Bahrain or whatever it may be? Probably not, because we would have to think long term, is this the right thing? So I think it's a mix of different things. That Kane got his shot, I got my shot, Drapes got his shot. So we all represented New Zealand. But I think at that point in time, if Kane was the best in the top 3 strikers, then he should be in. If it was Drapes, Drapes should be in. So, but obviously there's other things around that. Age as well. Is there any point in me coming back out of retirement to play for the All Whites? Probably not. Drapes, probably not. Kane, probably not. So I think it's a collective approach. It's different. It's tough. It must be tough for them.
I was talking to the great and wise Simon Kay tonight about you appearing on the show, and he was really interested to hear what you had to say because he's followed you. I don't know if you know who Simon Kay is. He works here at the Herald. But he was sort of saying, well, look, take the money out of it. Even if I had a 10, 12 year career as a professional footballer and I got spat out in my early 30s, that would be a huge success. I don't care how much money I've got in my bank account. If I've just had those experiences living as a pro and all the stories you've got and the countries you've been to and the stuff to tell your grandkids, you know, whatever it is, he thought of that as a great life. When you reflect back on your 12 years as a pro, journeyman pro, different clubs, different countries every couple of years, what do you think?
Can I jump in there? Yeah. How does that kind of journeyman football gypsy,
I don't like that.
That no football nomad,
I don't like that.
Yeah, how does that sit with you?
I don't like that because every time I moved, it was for a reason. Either I was pushed out, sold, wanted to leave for more game time. I didn't want to be a journeyman. I didn't want to move around. I loved my experiences in Hungary. I loved my experiences in Finland. I loved my experience in India. However, if someone had to put me in a team and I loved it there and I was happy for 12 years, then that's what I wanted. I did not like traveling. However, looking back now, I trained hard my whole life and I did what I love, and I'm still doing what I love now. So I think it's not to get philosophical or anything, but if you're doing what you love for 33 years, even if it's whatever, bus driver, whatever it may be, if you're doing what you love, then do it. I mean, it doesn't matter about the money. It doesn't matter about all that stuff. Like, I survived. I did okay. I had a good career. I need to work now, but I loved it. But did I want to go to Hungary? I probably didn't want to go to Hungary, but I did and I loved it. So I don't want to look back and regret anything. I regret certain decisions. I probably shouldn't have left one or two of the clubs. However, I don't like the name journeyman. I don't like being called that because my job was a professional footballer and I did that.
I think it's a real credit to your character that you stuck it out, because it was at times a turbulent path that you trod. And many people wouldn't have. We've had people on here who've talked about how difficult it is, that trialing process. You're trying to force someone out of a job. And you did it year after year, and you believed in your ability and you kept going. And not many people, I don't think, would have that same desire and that drive to keep going. So I don't know where that came from, and it's probably the same place that in your early years made you turn away the drink and the party boys and, you know, have that work ethic to actually succeed. But it's quite admirable, and I think it's quite a good lesson for any youngsters listening, that the way to succeed is you've got to make sacrifices, and you've got to make a lot of them, and you've got to make them regularly, and there are going to be really hard times. So we've touched on some of the hard times. And I just think it's good to reflect. And part of the success we've had the short term this podcast has been running has been when we've had guests in who have actually had a chance to reflect on their careers and what they've done. Because a lot of the time you don't actually get to talk about these things. You know, no one's really asking.
I've forgotten a lot of what you've asked me. Some of the questions you've asked, I've actually forgotten about certain things.
Yeah.
And I was actually on the phone to my wife on the way out, and I said, I'm really looking forward to this because no one's ever asked me. Like, everyone said, what was it like in Finland? Oh, no. Well, what was it really? What happened in Finland? My wife would do a run every day. And then the next day in the newspaper, there was a bear sighting and someone got attacked by a bear or something on the same route. It was something like that in the news. And, like, little things like that. I mean, that doesn't happen in Mount Albert. Does it?
It doesn't happen in Pirongia.
No. In Te Awamutu, there were nothing. So there's loads of different little stories and different things where I mean, I spoke to Piney once about maybe writing a book. I mean, I don't care if anyone reads it, but I'd like to sit down and go, oh, what happened there, and actually go through it. Where this podcast could be 5 hours long. The story, I mean, I was told
I don't have anywhere to go, so.
We're out of beers.
But I mean, there were so many things that I wish I could tell people. And no one's ever asked any questions. No one's really. But I think my coaching, what my career's kind of done is it's changed my coaching ideas. Like with my grammar boys this morning, I was loud. I was quite emotional, like not emotional, but the high intensity, the work ethic. If someone doesn't work hard at Auckland Grammar, they don't play. And guess what? I've lost one kid in 2.5 years. One kid, and he couldn't handle the work ethic. We came second in national tournament and second in Auckland. And I was talking to them about hoping we wouldn't get relegated most of the season because we lost a lot of players. And it's just that work ethic, work ethic, work ethic. And that's, I think, kind of what... That's the only thing that really got me going was just my work ethic. But I appreciate you guys asking questions because no one... I love reminiscing, to be fair.
What do you think your... How would you... You probably talked about this, maybe you haven't. How would your wife describe her experience of following you around these countries, these teams? Would the good outweigh the bad? Was she happy to move back to New Zealand?
I think the good outweigh the bad, but there were some very bad, very, very... bad times. There were some great times, but I think now we did that. We came home. I did always say, and we sacrificed a lot. We sometimes, when I was earning the footballer money, we didn't spend it. We were wise, knowing that when we came back, we'd like to buy a house, settle down, have a baby, and we've done that. And now we've got our lovely boy that just does not sleep at all. And is winds me up an absolute treat because...
Did you read that on the notes?
we've been told to ask you about your
kid's sleeping. He's an absolute shambles, but I love this kid. But still, like, the reward is now. So she's done that with me. Now I give her what she wants now, which is safe country, home. She has her parents down the road. She has her son. She has everything that she wants now, and that's her kind of... payback to a degree. But look, she loved it. She loved it. She loved India. She loved South Africa. We got married in South Africa, and it was the best day of our lives. So we would never have got married in South Africa if it wasn't for the football. She wouldn't have experienced so many things in 12 years. She came over when she was like 18.
Yeah.
Imagine her parents. I can't believe her parents let their daughter go with a so-called footballer with their reputation to Europe.
You're one of the good guys.
Oh, one of the great ones, Seamus.
Despite the terrible sleeping, how has being a dad and a parent changed you?
Oh, you know, like it changes everything, really. It changes absolutely everything. He's like, my whole life revolves around him. So if I get, I changed my training schedule the other week just so I could spend a bit more time with him, because now I need to make sure from 9 till 10 every Monday I'm swimming. So we went swimming this way. And again, he was a nightmare. He can't swim. He nearly drowned once in a 2 foot swimming pool. But it changes everything. So now my life revolves around coaching, being a dad. And
you mentioned earlier that, you know, you're coaching Central and you're working with some top quality players. I feel like, and I might be wrong, I might be off on this, but there's a little flame in the back with a little bit of burning desire. You said you didn't want to play in bad teams, but when you're coaching these good teams, there must be a little bit of you that's...
You're talking about my goal in training in August. August the 7th last year, aren't you? I know, yeah, definitely.
That's thinking, I would love to get out there and play with these boys.
And you know who my first signing was for Central? Actually, Ivan Vukcic told me to sign this player. It was me. So the first signing for Central, I signed myself. That's why we got no money anymore.
Truth comes out.
Yeah. So you're getting back out there.
And there was only one time I thought I would nearly play, and that was only because of numbers. I wanted my reserve, but I had 13 players in reserves, I think 11 in the first team at the start of the season. I just want everyone to play, and these kids are coming through amazing. But it got to the point last year where we were losing games 2-1, and we were getting bullied, and we had a lot of young boys. We got bullied a lot, and we got outworked, and that's not me. So I want my team to be a reflection of what I was like as a player and what I think my ideas are as a football coach. And so then I would train, someone would get injured or whatever, and I'd go, you know what, the last 10 would play 11-11, for example, and I'd get out there and, jeez, I scored this world. And Connor Tracy was in goal. I think Angel was there. He was before he went back to Spain. I've gone in midfield, slid in at Croatian club, like, pitch was so good.
Is this like the Spain thing?
No, this actually happened.
And in reality,
look, believe,
you shinned it in, it's hit you, it's gone in.
I think
Connor's having a drink.
No. Connor missed it. He's not quite there yet. But Sammy Khan knocked in this great 35-yard cross from the left. I've come steaming in from midfield. And yeah, it does, sometimes I do get frustrated, but it's so hard, like, to do it properly, if I'm to coach properly and to keep it professional as such. It's like... Yeah, I do pull myself out, but it is hard.
So is there any outlet? What about like a 7-a-side or a 5-a-side or something?
Do you know what annoys me?
Go on.
No one has asked me to play seven aside.
This is what the pod's here for. We had Cole Tinkler asking for a club, you know, last week. We've got you asking for a seven aside. If there's someone out there that's looking
for what's even worse? This is how bad it is.
Target man with bad knees.
Last year, so when I first got the Central job, I caught up Connor Kay O'Fahey. Been at Central's whole life, went to Three Kings for a bit, but I thought, I'll bring the kid back. Brought him back and he goes, I've got to go. I've got a seven-a-side semi-final. I said, look, he goes, we're struggling for numbers. Like, I'll call you back soon. Whoa, where are you playing? Anderson Park. I've got my boots. And no, it's all right, Brody.
No, we're right.
So I called him back that night, signed him. Then I said, all right, when's the final? He goes, final's next week. He goes, we're struggling for numbers. I said, right, what time do you need me to be there? Like, we'll win. I said, what's the prize money? I don't care. You can keep it. Shit amongst the boys, whatever, a few pairs. I thought, yeah, just win the game for them. Didn't ask me. I changed Auckland City youth team training schedules from like the season before to have every Wednesday off. We trained Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, I think it was.
I had
every Wednesday off. And I said to my wife, look, I'm just saying, you know, I booked it out in our calendar, our family calendar.
It's amazing.
It hurts.
And nobody called me.
This is
only
amazing.
Time they called me was Whitey was desperate one day and there was like an internet. It was like a one-day tournament, like a few.
You've still got something to offer, Brighty. He's in good nick. For anyone listening, he's in good nick.
Oh, stop it, yeah.
It looks like he's still got a little something. Brighty, we've covered a lot already, but we've probably brushed over a lot. I mean, it's 10 years. It's a decade of professional football in these different countries. What stands out to you as the stories, the most memorable stories?
There's so many different types of stories. There's the ones on the pitch. There's the ones off the pitch. There's what could have been. There's so many different ones. I think the one that got me the most, and my wife laughs every time I say it, I can't believe she laughed when it happened, but the classic was when I was in Finland, EFK Mariehamn. You actually said that very close. It was very good.
Thank you very much.
Better than you said Hungary.
I don't know why you said Hungary with an accent.
Hungary.
Hungary. So I was in Finland, and I did okay. I was doing pretty well. I think I had someone like 7 and 12 games or something, and this team from Poland came in for me just like it was probably 2 weeks before the transfer window, and they were going to pay a certain amount. We only had like 10 games to go or something, so the club was like seeing money, so yeah, great. So they said, come over and do a medical and then come back. I said, do I need my boots? They said, oh, I'll just do it just in case for the medical. Turned up, got off the plane, went straight to the training ground, played in the game. I was like, Jesus, okay.
Lucky you brought your boots.
Lucky I brought my boots, Seamus. So I just brought a little bag. I was only going there for 2 days max. Played, scored. We won 2-1, played okay. I can remember it really well. And I went in after I said, what's going on here? Oh, no, it's fine. We were a man short. No, you weren't. Just talking bollocks to me. Anyway, I went off, did my medical. Brilliant. Next day, flew back to, had to fly to Sweden and catch a boat to Finland. So I got on the plane, stayed the night in Sweden, all sorted. I'm like to my wife, geez, we're going to Poland. Like, she's like, Jesus, like, I'm not sure about this one, Chris. Like, this is a bit of a joke.
Too far, Chris.
Like,
I'm out.
Like, Finland, yeah.
Followed you to India, but
Malta, yes, I'll
yeah,
do Malta.
Yeah, but Poland, really? But it was a good way. It was a good wage. It was a good club, brand new stadium, like, brilliant. And I thought, yeah, this is all right. Coach loved me, which I thought was brilliant. Anyway, on the boat from Sweden to Finland, I get a phone call. Chris, where are you? I said, I'm just on a boat, like, going back to the club, going to get my stuff. Like, the club was informed, like, that transfer, they're trying to find a replacement. Transfer fee, like, good transfer fee. And he goes, Chris, you need to get to a hospital. No, mate, I'm fine. No, you need to get to a hospital. Your blood test results have come back from your medical. Your white blood cells have diminished and you're going to die within 2 weeks. So this is a German agent who I knew pretty well. He must have been about 70, honestly. And he goes, look, you're really serious at all. They said you're either a terrible, terrible alcoholic, and I said, funny enough, I'm not. And then they said, oh, you'll take steroids. I said, yep, possibly, but it looks like I know
I
a lot.
I started lines when I was 13, so it's on the table.
So I said, mate, I said, like, I'm fine. I just played in a game, like, I'm the fittest in the team. Just calm yourself down. Chris, get to a hospital. Phone cuts out in the middle of bloody ocean, right? So I start panicking. So I'm on a boat in between Sweden and Finland, panicking, thinking, oh, my God. Phone died. Finally got close to Finland. I called my dad. Dad, I'm going to die. Dad's like, no, you're not. Dad, I'm going to die. And his dad's wife is a nurse. she's like, oh, you're not going to die.
When you're calling your dad saying I'm going to die,
goodbye.
What percentage are you thinking you're really going to die?
Loves a percentage.
I love a percentage.
67?
Are you
a good 65 to 67%?
So you're genuinely thinking.
Just, I'm a hypochondriac when it comes to illnesses. I'm great with injuries. I'm fine, but
just as an aside, tip for anyone that may come on the podcast or encounter Stephen in real life. If he asks you a percentage question, never say 100%.
Well, give yourself some room.
Yeah. To never ever say that you're 100% locked in with anything.
Okay.
No, good tip.
And don't say 110% either.
No,
Oh God, don't get me started on 110%.
Anyway, I digress.
But if 67 is a real guesstimate of where your mind was.
Genuinely, yeah.
That is terrifying. So, that is absolutely terrifying. So if you 67% think you're going to die.
Have you ever been thought 67% that you're going to die, Steve?
No.
Neither.
Anything close to 67%?
No. God, no. That is...
So my missus is asleep. Dad picked up, so I don't know why he picked up. This must have been like 3 a.m. Anyway, get off the boat. This is the... So the chairman picks me up and goes... I told him, I said, oh my God. And he goes... No, you're fine. He goes, is a transfer going ahead? I can't get hold of him. There's a transfer going ahead. Like, forget that. Get me to a hospital. Forget that. Takes me to the stadium of all places. We're going through paperwork for the transfer. Get me to it. So I started running to the hospital. So
Shouldn't do that if you're an elevated white blood cell count.
So I started running. And I remember running going, I don't feel amazing here. Like, I don't feel amazing. So then he picks me up. He takes me back to the stadium. I'm like, is this serious? He goes... I said, my liver was failing. That's what was the problem. My liver was failing. And then he goes to me, you did look a little bit yellow when you turned up. Like, you do look a bit yellow. I'm like, just, mate, get me to the hospital. So I get to the hospital and the doctors are like, calm down. So I did all the tests and then the whole team came. So they stopped training.
Wow. Memorial.
So they stopped training. They all came. And I remember being in this little room.
What?
And I'm lying on this bed and my whole teammates around. Honestly, it's so funny. And they're like.
You're still at 67% at this point?
I was higher.
You're bumping up. You're getting up to the 80s.
The doctors are like chilled. The doctors are proper chilled. And then by this point, it was a little bit later. So like my dad's wife was on the phone to me going like, don't worry, you're going to be fine. And so then everyone left and the chairman came in. And the chairman goes, I need you to sign this piece of paper because the transfer needs to go through. Because, this is a good bit of money for us. And I just said, look, mate, get out. Like, just get out. So anyway, long story short, I was fine. They said, no, you're sweet. So my Chris Turner's sister is a top doctor over here. And I spoke to him and said, look, yeah. I got the blood test result. And genuinely, like, it was really bad. Like, my bilirubin and even my liver was like, pew. But it could have just been, it was an abnormal reading. Like, I was fine, obviously. So anyway, a couple of things. I didn't eat for 2 days. Like, I missed the game. Transfer deadline went past. So anyway, I was sitting outside a cafe. I was about to go in the cafe. I was sitting in the car and the German guy called again. This is like 3 days after. He goes, Chris, I've been speaking to the club. They're happy to do the transfer again. They've got the money. I said, transfer deadline's gone. Don't talk to me. No. So this is the thing. They're going to pay the money and they're going to pay your salary. I think my salary, I'll tell you what my salary was. I think it was going to be, in New Zealand dollars, it would have been around about $16,000 cash a month.
Take it.
So, but...
It's a good deal.
Good deal. What percentage chance do you think you would take that, Stephen? 110?
Oh, God, no. Never. No. You're not being honest with yourself. You're saying 110. No. We'll go 99.9%. We'll take that.
You're taking it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
16 grand a month.
16 grand a month. And I'm going, I said, my missus, I said, hey, there's a couple of handbags, love. Like, let's let's go. So anyway, he sits outside the, was it 16,000? It can't have been that. It was.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
I can tell you what it was in euros. It was about, I tell you what, it was about 14. It was about 14 grand, seriously.
Take it.
Still take it?
Yeah.
So anyway.
The percentage goes down.
So the agent calls me up and he goes, look, this is the problem. So what they're going to do is they're going to pay you, and I'll talk in New Zealand dollars, like you said, they're going to pay you $6,000 a month for 2.5 years. However, if you're still alive at the end of the 2.5 years, they'll back pay you the rest of the money. I said, nah, you've got to be joking.
If you're still alive,
after, imagine getting a knock at the door with like 2 days to go. You'll be going, no, I'm staying in bed.
Don't take that deal.
We're out now. So,
That's got to be all time low, right? If you're 67% that you're going to die, that's got to be the worst.
Is that the worst?
Over that, it was only a short period of time, but that's got to be the lowest of the decade overseas.
Yeah, that was pretty bad. And the funny thing was, my wife wasn't around my girlfriend at the time, my wife now, she wasn't there. She was actually shopping in London with her Norwegian friend, and she was just laughing the whole time.
She was using the 16 grand in advance.
Oh, she honestly.
14 grand.
I'll tell you what, one more. Obviously, it's getting late. I'll tell you one other one. So,
I've got loads of time.
Oh, my God. This is before I went to Moneyham, so this must have been a year earlier. I had an agent that was pretty good. He got me one or two deals. He was pretty good, English guy. And I was staying at my cousin's house in England, and my wife was still in New Zealand, and we would just come back over looking for a club, trialing here and there, I think. Anyway, he goes, how would you like to go to Russia? I said, oh, now we're talking. I think this is at the same time.
Now we're talking.
Russia, the dream. Get me behind the iron curtain.
And this is when Costa was there. Because Costa was like,
Alania bloody covers.
That's the one. He's rolling in a bit there. He's getting a bit more than 16 grand a month, to tell you that. Mm. So anyway, he goes, how would you like to go to Russia? Yeah. I'll go there. And I said, what kind of money we're talking about? And like, he threw out some numbers. And compared to like my last contract, it was like, chuck a zero on the end. It was like, and I had to be
£160,000 a week.
So
take it.
He goes, he said, it's like, honestly, it was Novo, it was a genuine team.
Doesn't sound like it.
It was in the mountains. Like, it was the worst possible place you could be.
Because where Costa wasn't great, was it?
No, but this
place.
That
was an asshole of a place to get someone out to go and play a tournament in Saudi Arabia, I can tell you.
Oh, wow.
Thanks for your honesty.
Yeah. So I've gone, look, sweet. So you have to go get an HIV test to get a visa. So I've gone to like the sex health clinic in Canterbury in England, like with my wife, and there's some certain types of people in there that are, it was a dodgy place. And I'm getting, can I get an HIV test for a visa? Yep, certainly, sir. So I didn't get my results, actually, come to think of it. But anyway, after that, visa's all done. Waiting for the visa to come back. Contract agreed. You'll love this. It was a 1.5 year contract with a 1 year option.
One and a half plus one.
Is that what they call it? Yeah. So anyway, so I've gone out. I've splashed the cash. So it was winter in England. So my wife come over now. So she's flown over, straight over. We've gone shopping with all the winter clothes. It was like -20 in Russia. I bought a brand new laptop, Beats headphones. I bought everything because I thought, if I'm going to live in this shithole of a place, I'm going to have all the best appliances. Bought like computer, about everything. And then he goes, oh, you have to pay you for your visa. I said, mate, they're paying me a bucket load here. They can pay. It was only like £300 for the visa. You can pay for it. I am paying for it. You pay for it. It was a Western Union account. So my dad, who is like a detective, he tracked the Western Union account to a Cameroonian dogfighting syndicate. Nowhere, and he sent me all the paperwork. Cameroonian. So I said to my agent, hey, look at this paperwork. It's going to Cameroon, Western Union Cameroon dogfighting syndicate. That's what they're known for. Fuck you, Chris. If you're not going to take this, you're a disgrace. You're going to end up, I've got the email. You're going to end up playing pub football in New Zealand again. You're shit anyway. Just pay the money. And this guy's got Premier League players. So I refused to pay, and he goes, fuck it, I'm going to get this other guy on the plane. And he said, yep, he's going to take it. So I was sitting in Canterbury, still unemployed, with gadgets for days, probably about a few grand's worth of gadgets, with no contract. And then I signed for Moneyham in Finland for peanuts.
But Shay, can we get some links to some Cameroon dogfighting syndicates in the show notes?
I think we can probably do that,
if anyone's interested in
Yaounde.
That's amazing. There's some great stories. There's a few bits and pieces here on our comprehensive list of notes that I want to touch on. One of them, and I think I don't have the full details here, but it might have been a Kings game where you got pulled out of the crowd.
Terrible. To
do one of the halfway shots.
Oh my God, who told you? That's amazing. Mm-hmm. That is amazing.
Take the story.
It was
from
like a National Youth League. We were undefeated, 6 games from 6. Didn't concede a goal. Great team, Sam Jasper, Micah Guiver. Good side. Anyway, so we had a game against...
Soccer 2 it would have been then, wouldn't
no,
it?
No, I was United Soccer 1, Seamus.
Oh, sorry. Gotcha.
If you're going to bring me on the show, know your facts.
Manurewa, so...
I'm from there, but I travelled. You should. I travelled for the best environment.
Mercenary.
Yeah. So...
Pritch doing his work. Keith Pritchett, friend
of the
show.
It was a bit of Pritch. Friend of the show. Hi, Keith. So we went over... So we played at Waikato Stadium against whoever it was. White team Waikato. What are they called down there? I don't know.
You should know. Force 3, I think you'll find it.
Force 3.
Force 3,
wow.
What a name. What
it was Force 3.
Name, that is,
yeah. So we played in that game, like we won the game. And then we're all up in the stands, right at the top of the stands, with both. I think Cozzy was there. So we're up in the stands, and then they said, right in the thing, check your program. And if you've got like a golden ticker or you've got a thing and you think like that means you go at halftime, kick a goal, kick it in the goal from halfway, you win something. So I think it was Cozzy or someone like next to Cozzy that from their team that got it. And they're like, oh, no, I'm not doing this. I'll be too nervous. It got passed to someone else to our team. And they're like, no, I'm not going to do it. I was like, well, fuck, I'll do it. So I said, Jasper, come with me, though. And so Jasper comes down with me. And I run into the box where my stepdad, Chris, is there because obviously he's with the Kings. And I said, Chris, I've got the golden ticket here. I'm going, well, here. And the whole box is like, go on, Chris, go down there, go and get it done. So I've gone down there and I've gone, hey, I do things properly, Stephen, Seamus. I do things properly. If I want to shoot from half, I'm going to put my boots on.
Of course you're going
to
put your boots on.
I went back to the bus, to the bus, found the bus driver. This is all quick, by the way. Found the bus driver, got the boots, went downstairs, put my boots on. And they looked at me and were like, why have you got boots? Don't you worry about that, mate. Just fine, give me the ball. Went out to the halfway line, Jasper's staying off, and I've gone, and I've got it in. So as I've got it in, I can see up in the crowd, obviously Kings.
Did you get it in?
Yeah, got it in.
I can't believe you're going to get the boots though. Like surely the shoes would have done the job.
It was $1,000, I think it was.
This man doesn't follow rules. He got told not to take his boots to Poland, and he took his boots to Poland.
So I've gone, we've done a big stomach slide, like a Klinsman with Jasper. Like we've gone, all the boys, both teams are going crazy.
Have you made deals with how you're going to split the money pre-kick? So the syndicate.
I can see the box with like Chris and stuff. They're all loving it. So anyway, I was working at Score Sportswear with the Dawkins at time, and Jasper was there as well. And Greg Clark, hopefully friend of the show, busy on Facebook. Lynn Avon, tall center. Remember?
Yeah, I remember Greg Clark. Yeah.
Great guy. Carl Phipps as well. He was there. So we're working, and he did his work in his room, and he listened to Radio Sport. I think it was. Shout out to Radio Sport again. Well,
and here you are in the studio.
Oh yeah, beautiful. There we are. Anyway, on the radio, he's like, Brighty, you need to come and listen to this. So they're slagging me off. They're slagging Chris off because the Kings had some financial difficulties, which, to be fair, no one knows about. And in all fairness to Chris. Chris was, I say stupid enough, but he put a lot of what he had into the Kings to keep them alive. If it wasn't for Chris, the Kings would have died a year before it did, and the Kings wouldn't have happened, and so on and so forth. But anyway, so what had happened was everyone was saying, this is dodgy, they're struggling that much for money that the guy's stepson, they've made go and score, and the money's going back to the club.
Yeah, conspiracy theories.
No word. That's what everyone was saying on Radio Sports. Yeah. So Chris has called me up and gone, hey, and the whole work, like Rex Dawkins has come down and gone, like, so Chris has said, I said, look, I was like really upset. I'm like, I want it fair and square. $1,000. Like, I was earning $9.15 an hour.
Yeah.
$1,000. I'm trying to save up to go to England.
Yeah.
And he goes, Chris, look, I think it was from Duty Free Regency. It was Duty Free or something. And I said, look, I'm going to give the money back. And Chris goes, great idea. I was like, fuck, Chris. Sir. Like, he called my bluff. And then we decided that. So 20 minutes later, Radio Sport goes, we've just found out that Chris was listening to the show and he decided to give the money back. And then Duty Free gave me like a watch or something. They were like, oh, fair enough. Like, here's a watch. But yeah. I genuinely gave the money back.
Nice.
And I was pissed off. Because I was in the crowd and all the boys had no balls to do it. And I was like, you know what? I could get it in from half. I just rolled it in.
Yeah.
Lost a grand that day.
Are you side footing there? Are you going with the laces?
I remember because even Jasper was like, because it was dewy. It was quite late at night. It was
Andrew
dewy.
Dewhurst was there, wasn't he?
Dewey was doing everything, wasn't he? He was on the speaker going, here comes. So, Seamus, get off the floor here. Go on. But yeah, it was. Jeez, yeah.
All right,
wow.
good yarn. Another one I've got, and I'm just going to let you run with this. Are you still doing pyramid schemes?
What? Well, is that the old Herbalife?
You tell us, mate.
You take that in whichever direction you want.
Herbalife is a great product. Well, it was. That's what they told me.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I wanted to do something outside of football, and after Lincoln, I was again out of contract, and a couple of players were earning big bucks from it at Lincoln, like doing really, really well. So they got me on board. I bought bucket load of products, sold basically zero.
Oh, God.
And we had Herbalife for breakfast, lunch and dinner for about three. Hey, we got in great nick.
There's a lot of admin in Herbalife. I jumped on that bandwagon a few years
Did
back
you?
And there's a lot of admin. There's a lot of pills to take.
Not selling it, like,
oh,
as
God,
a
no, I was consuming it. Can't you tell?
Did you see that? Did you see that Herbalife Netflix documentary about the exposing the dark underbelly of the pyramid scheme?
You mentioned Lincoln City.
Yes.
Were you there when Alan Pearce was there?
No, but they knew Alan.
I'm sure they did. They signed him.
They knew Alan because obviously, look, there's not many New Zealand footballers floating about, and if one's there before, then they said Alan was decent. Mm. A few years later, we're playing for Three Kings together.
Mm.
What about the ice packs? Are they still going?
The ice packs, Jesus, Seamus. Yeah, the ice packs kept me alive for about 3 to 6 months. I tell you what, Rolly bought a bucket. In fact, Rolly, you must be needing some more stock in about around March. You should be needing some more stock. So give me a call. I've got another 5,000 coming over from China in a few weeks.
So they are still going?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Roland's my main supplier, one and only.
I know Kris tried to get them into through Oceania, and I think that's good idea.
That only came about because my dad came over to see me when I after I broke my leg. My dad came to Norway, and I said I had all these ice packs because the club gave me the ice packs. So in Norway it's crazy because it was freezing, but they had these ice packs. So whenever we travelled, you know, that you squeeze them, it pops. You shake them, they're cold. They were brilliant. My dad was like, they're not in New Zealand. Why didn't you just bring them out? So then Kris, I took some home. Kris decided to do it for a while. And then when I was, again, in between contracts having surgery back here, I got into it, sold. I must have sold about 50,000 of them.
50,000?
It's a lot of units.
It's a lot of units.
That's a lot.
That's 20 plus 20.
Speaking
plus
of 10. Big units, you played in India. Which is?
I thought you were going to talk about yourself then.
No. I never played in India.
All right. Sorry.
Talk us through that because it was a rebel. It was a breakaway competition, not under the All India Football Federation.
Yeah.
In the I League around the IPL.
Well, I don't think we were the breakaway. I think there's a Super League that like Roy's in now. That was the breakaway.
But that's now affiliated.
So it was really. I went to India 2 years too early. Or actually too late, but the year I went was messy. So our owner was the 700th richest man in the world. Like, it was ridiculous. So he lost, I think, $4 million on our team, which is in the first year, like we were rubbish as well. But that's just like you and I dropping like a couple of bucks.
Is the 400th richest man in the world?
I think it was his
multi-billionaire.
Multi-billionaire. This guy was like quite approachable as well.
Yeah.
His surname was Kalyani, like Kalyani Steele or Barrett Steele or something. I don't know.
It's like a porn star name.
Lexington Steele. Yeah. But I think you're getting him confused with Stephen.
So the owner's son was like a keen. It was typical, like the owner had all the money. The son was like, I want to have my own football team, Dad. And then he got involved and it was great. But they spend more money on popcorn for the crowd and fireworks and like good balls for training. But we had a couple of good foreign players. It was I enjoyed it, but it was I played in a place called Shillong. Like, we were earning great money. The guy had so much money, but we were staying in like it was just one of the worst places I've been. Shillong, which was I think we lost, but we couldn't care less. We just wanted to get out. It was a weird league. But obviously now in that Super League, completely different story.
I'm going to throw an obscure name out because people, I like doing that. Was Aaron Bordica around?
Oh, he always asks.
I don't know who that is.
Obscure
I feel
names.
A bit bad saying that. Who is it?
I'm going to do some Googling and I'll put it on there.
Right. Brighty, it's nearly 11 o'clock on a school night and we still have to drive back to Hamilton. So we're going to start wrapping up. If you're listening. But I want to ask what's next. I want to ask what the future holds. You're obviously an ambitious coach. Is the dream gig to be a professional coach? Where does the future lie?
I'm quite, like I said, I've got a bit of an addictive personality and I tried to be the best footballer I could. Now I want to be try and be the best coach I can to help as many young boys here and to get overseas or to play professionally or even just to play in the Northern Prem or to play. So I help a lot of boys and I'd like to keep, and girls now, so I'd like to keep helping these Kiwi boys and trying to give them the experience that I got, which is obviously slightly different to the likes of Winston and Chris, which is completely different style of experience. But what's next? I don't know. Like I said before, I'm kind of nearly at the peak of what I feel like I can do in this sort of chapter of my coaching career. Obviously, I'd love to be in the National League, but that's very difficult. And I'm in at Auckland City and Jose's doing a great job and the club's in a great place right now. But I think, like I said to him, my playing career, the highlight of my playing career was playing for New Zealand. And I think I ran into Andy Boyens a few months ago and I said to him, I said, look, if I can't play for New Zealand, I'd love to coach New Zealand. So I know what New Zealand football's about. I know what it's like here. I know what it's like in different cultures and different things. So I'd love to try and give that back to an under-17s group or an under-20s group, whatever it may be. And maybe it's too soon, maybe it's not, but certainly if they were asking for applicants in the, for the upcoming 17s or 20, if there were coaches needed, then I would 100% or probably 110%, Stephen, put in my name on the hat.
God, don't get me started.
No.
Well, that's a great, it's a great place to pitch your coaching potential. Between Two Bears is a place for the guests come on. Shay's touting himself as an agent. Cole's looking for clubs. Brighty's, you know, sending a direct message to Boyens and Craig Pragnell.
Is Andy on Facebook? Or has he probably gone? He's big time now, and he would have gone off Facebook.
So, I guess last question for me is: what if a coaching job came up somewhere outside of Auckland? You've sort of bounced around a lot of places. Would you be prepared to leave Auckland for a National League coaching job?
Good question.
It's a great question, Stephen. It's probably the best one of the night. I think career-wise, if it was the right thing, then I probably would. The only issue in New Zealand is, and I know it's tough in New Zealand coaching, is that could I justify to my family to go to Nelson, whatever it may be, for it's not exactly the highest paying job in the world in terms of survival, but I did, it was the same in my playing career. I went to Malta and I went to Finland in certain times when I was earning very, very, very little because it was a stepping stone.
Yep.
But I think I would love to stay in Auckland for my son's sake. I've not seen my dad for all my family, my brothers for 12 years. My brother's 19, 20 now and I barely know him. Because I was away for most of his life. So there's things like that I would love to stay in Auckland. However, I think the next thing for me I ideally is keep learning, keep doing what I can do here, and then maybe in a few years we head on off again somewhere like wherever it may be.
Nice. Shay, thoughts on Chris's interview tonight?
No, it was great. I really enjoyed that. I think there's a lot of New Zealand football stories hidden away there, and I think yours is a really good one that we've been able to kind of share. I'm a list guy, and I've still got things not ticked off on my list, which we might have to save for a part two.
Well, there might be a part two
sometime in
part
the
two. Might be part two. We're going to have to start bringing guests back because everyone's got so much to say.
Well, let's see how much abuse people are hogging and write in the comments and whatnot. Yeah. And
that's been awesome, Chris. So thanks so much for coming on and sharing and being open, and we really appreciate it. And hope to have you on again should this podcast continue into the future.
Yeah, thank you very much. Pretty appreciate it. Cheers.